Yeah, he's actually down.
Oh, yeah. We're just saying we're back visuals now, and thanks for your patience, everyone. Hopefully, the errors have gone now. Gareth?
As I say, like you say, Dave, he's down on his own time slightly, but still up on Cooper's time. And look at that, he's nearly 3.5 tenths up in Sector 2. That puts him 2 tenths up on Cooper. Now, can he withstand this at the end of the lap? Because he lost a slight amount in the last sector on his previous hot lap. Let's see if he can keep it this time. He's run slightly wide, though. He's gone very wide there. That's cost him the lap now, I reckon. And he's got Toyota on the inside there, a bit of traffic now. Maybe slight distractions there, because there's a few yellow flags out. But Dave Carr-Smith looking like he has the pace to challenge for this pole position.
And he's going again as well. He's kept his foot in, so he ran wide, but obviously he was on the AstroTurf, so it's not the ultimate grip, but you may still get more than you would on the grass. Yeah, it went in the end, but he's obviously fueled for a long run here, and he's just going to keep pounding the laps out and keep the tyre temperature up. It's not a bad strategy, I must admit, because obviously the nature of these tyres will allow you to go and do more laps on them, but it would be interesting to see if it pays dividends for him, because the other three guys with Cooper, Helston... Oh, Dave's just spun on the board. He's starting to go off a little bit now.
So it's interesting to see that you can get two or three, you know, possibly even four hot laps out of these tyres if you look after them properly. I mean, Dave there put in what would have been a pole position lap, I believe, if he hadn't have messed up the final sector, you know, on his fourth hot lap. So we've got Helston, the other three are out as well. Now we've got Cooper, Kassar and Helston all back out on track. Helston's probably the man to watch at the moment, because Helston's gone up on his own time in Sector 1 by a tenth, and it's slightly off Cooper's. And he's the man that's furthest round on his next hot lap.
Yeah, big lock up right-hander before he comes into the back straight, though, so he may have cost him a bit of time. Well, he's matched Cooper. He's 2 tenths up on his own time, but he's only half a tenth off Cooper. And, is Ben Warren going to... Yeah, he is. That's a good job from Ben Warren there in the inner vision, as he Helston sweeps into the final sector now. Very technical section. It's the most technical one of the track, and it's probably most taxing for the driver as well, because especially these two corners... The gearing has to be right, the aerodynamics have to be right, so it's very, very, very technically difficult, and gifts it to the real drivers, this part of the track, as he comes to the line now, and he's just a tenth and a half off, but he's personal improvement and moved second.
Yeah, Cooper seems very quick in that final sector. I mean, that's three people I've watched now have been up on him at Sector 2, but he comes to Sector 3, and they lose like a 2-3 tenths every time. Cooper's coming around to the line now on his own hot lap. He's not improving on this lap. He's a good 3 tenths off. And the next man who's going to improve from that is Kassar. I believe Kassar's just jumped up, actually, hasn't he? He's done...
No, Helston jumps to second, and Kassar's currently on third on a flying lap.
Ah, that's right, yeah. I would say Dave's dropped down, obviously it's Helston who's jumped up. Helston now, though, look at that, 3 tenths up in Sector 1 on his own time, and 2.5 tenths up on Cooper. And Kassar's up in middle sector as well on Cooper by a tenth and a half, so we've got possible improvement. Kassar is the man to watch at the moment. Kassar's the one who's coming around to complete this lap. Got a slight bit of traffic in front of him, but I don't think he'll catch it. It's Sam Miller.
Yeah, he's really committed through these corners as well. He's flying through some of these corners, so... There's a lot of commitment here, and there's a lot of grip coming up from these front tyres now. They've really started to heat up. A little bit of oversteer
slightly
there.
Slightly wide, yeah.
Yeah, got on the power as he comes through the final corner. He'll direct it straight for the line now. Keep it as straight as you possibly can. It's quite bumpy to start straight, so he comes to the line. Oh, he's lost it again. So
Helston behind him is 2.5 tenths up, and he's coming across the line any second now. He's entering the final corner. He runs slightly wide into the second to last corner. Coming from the final corner, he's hard on the power. Heading towards the line now. Let's see if he can maintain the 2.5 tenths that he's got over Alex Cooper. As he crosses the line, takes pole by a tenth, goes into 28.9. So they're matching now their previous best from practice. Now, it'll take something really heroic to get faster than 28.9, 28.8 zone, I reckon.
Looking at the best laps by driver on live races, which I'll tweet the link to in a minute, Alex Cooper did once set a 128.6, so it's not impossible, but whether he'll be able to do it in this session, we'll have to find out.
The thing we don't know, obviously, is with that lap time, is if he was running wide at the corners, obviously, because you don't have a race admin looking at you. I mean, he might not have done it, it might have been a genuine lap time, but what I saw in practice was him cutting the corners. Whether it was intentional or not, it was actually benefiting him lap time. And he wasn't the only one doing it, I'm not trying to single him out or anything. Dave is trying to make his way for some traffic, now he's trying to start his fast lap. So, again, Dave in a lot of traffic, he's not having much luck at the moment with this.
No, traffic's a big issue at the moment, not much bigger than I thought it was going to be. Lee, just to go back on a point, it goes to show once again with Helston, he crossed the line and only improved overall by a tenth, but it just goes to show how good Alex Cooper is in that final sector. I don't know if it's the momentum through the two right-handers or if he's just able to get out the final corner better than anyone else, but he's got a huge advantage there that's given him a big upper hand when it comes to probably in the race as well.
Yeah, it's a good 2 tenths, isn't it?
It's about 2 tenths quicker than anyone else. He looks like he's struggling compared to the others in the first two sectors, but he has enough of an upper hand advantage that he's going to be thereabouts regardless of what happens.
But what that says to me is he's slightly more downforce, because the final sector is where you really gain it if you've got more downforce, more grip, better traction. And obviously the first two sectors are quite high speed, especially the second sector. But I'm just looking at Dave again. He got balked again at the beginning of this lap by O'Connor, which is a shame for Dave because he's got a good pace in that car. He's up in fourth still doing a good job, but I reckon he could challenge for that pole if he could just get a clean lap in.
I tend to agree, but like you said, that's twice now. So Scott Woodworth and O'Connor now have both really compromised Dave on his laps. He's not catching a break here. This is almost turning into Le Mans style driving, just trying to dodge the GT cars. He's going to catch O'Connor again before the start of this lap. This is turning into a night. Oh, thankfully O'Connor's pitted, so Dave's going to have a clear run on this run now. I believe this is will be his second flying lap on these tyres, I believe, Lee.
His second, yeah, it's his second hot lap now. There's no real surprises down the field either, to be honest. There's no one really excelling themselves who you wouldn't really normally expect to. Ben Warren, I think, could improve a lot. He was up in practice in the top 10. He's currently 15th, so Ben's got a lot more to come. Rick Scott as well, you'd expect to see him a bit further up. He's in the CSG team, teammate to P2 Alex Cooper. So you've got to believe that they're sharing the same data, if not similar. Apart from that, there's no one really excelling themselves. Timo Toyka's doing a decent job. He's up in 19th, so... keep it up, team. You're doing a good job there. You're not last. You're nowhere near last. You're a good 8 or 9 places in front of the final placement at the moment. So good job from Timo as he spins, as I say that.
Someone else who is doing a very good job and who's crept under the radar a little bit is Phil Cullen, up in 5th position at the moment. He's just silently sitting there. He's a few tenths behind the person in front of him, about a second actually. About a second behind. But he is up there nevertheless. 5th position,
yeah,
for Phil Cullen.
I was just watching on board with Phil, actually. Looks like he's got some good grip in that car, and if he maybe a bit more commitment through some of the corners, and he may start to knock on the door of where the position for Dave Carr-Smith, and also the same applies for Jack Nicholls. He's only 2 tenths behind Phil Cullen, so there's a lot of potential there for both those drivers to jump up quite significantly. Fiddick also, less than half a tenth behind Nicholls.
Dave's had a massive accident in the final sector. He was a tenth upon his final time. He had a slight bit of traffic going into that final sector. He's had a massive moment off the third to last corner, I presume it was. He's gone sideways out of the exit there, slammed into the wall, lost the rear wing, the suspension's all pointing the wrong way. Dave having a bit of a disaster at the moment in this session. He's P4 still, so not all, you know, not the end of all, but he's got a lot more pace in that if he could just get a clean run.
With 9 minutes to go then, it's the calm, sorry Dave, sorry Nick even, so with this calm before the storm, so we'll quickly, very quickly in fact, run down the top 10 so far. Rickard Hellsten sits top 128.9, puts him there, Alex Cooper P2, row 2 is Petter Kassar and Dave Carr-Smith, Phil Cullen is row 3, and finishing off that row is of course Jack Nicholls.
Yeah, some position is still Fiddick, and then comes down to 8th place for Muscat. Bennett is in 9th, and Pestos is in 10th.
Alright,
and after that, it's a gaggle of cars very close together. There's a lot of cars separated by very little. And the big surprise for me, actually, the man that I didn't really see the first time, Sam Miller. Down in P19. Now he's a podium man from last year in Super League, and he's down in P19. So he's not far in front of Timo, half a tenth. So got a lot of work to do, Sam.
He's done 8 laps as well, so maybe he was just impeded a little bit. He just very shaky in the entrance of the little chicane there, but and on the exit as well, he's having problems.
Yeah, he's got a lot of problems with grip. He downshifted to almost look like too quick. The engine not really helping too much at the moment, and then also flicked into the left in the start of the first part of the first sector, and I think it's turn 3 actually, and just spun out straight away, so he's got a few issues in that car and looks like he really is struggling.
There's been no significant improvements from the top, let's say, 4 for the last 10 minutes now, oh, sorry 5 minutes or so, because I know the track temperature's gone up slightly, but I expect it to affect it this much. None of them seem to be able to improve their lap times or even match the lap times. Although Cooper's P pretty much bang on his original lap time. If he does his previous final sector again, and maybe even improves it, he could possibly take pole, despite the fact he's nearly 3 tenths down, but he's gone very wide into that corner there. So Cooper looking like he can't actually match his final sector, which gave him the advantage before. Dave's just started.
He's got Muscat just in front of him there, who spun. That was a little bit of a...
Yeah, he's up and already gone, to be honest. I think he made a mistake in the third to last corner, but Dave Carr-Smith, if we join him now, I think he's probably the next bloke who's probably going to improve, if anyone is. He's just starting his hot lap now. He seems to have a clear track this time. He's hooking it up very nicely so far. He's on, I believe, his third lap. No, actually, it's a fresh tyre, isn't it, because he crashed. He's on a fresh set of tyres. Let's see what he can do. And in sector one, he's pretty much matched his personal best in his attempt from down on Helston currently.
Yeah, it's the first person of the front runners we've seen that's actually going to maybe start to improve their times, which is encouraging. Looks like there's still potential in the track. But, yeah, I believe there's a lot of traffic out there, which has caused a lot of issues for these drivers. Obviously, Dave Carr-Smith twice... Bumps in his lap, which has been really unfortunate. Let's see where he is. Wow, he's 2 tenths up on his own time, and he's only a tenth, well, nearly 2 tenths off Helston. So let's see if he can have an Alex Cooper style final sector.
He lost a little bit there on the exit of the fast chicane. Now, obviously, the tyre is still not fully up to operating temperature or the optimum temperature. He ran slightly wide onto the kerb, which bottoms the car out, and basically the car doesn't accelerate, it just stays at constant speed. Once again, he gets to the final sector, and he's got yellow flags out, though. He's not having much luck in this final sector. And to be honest, Helston wasn't that strong in his final sector, so if, like you say, you can match Alex Cooper's
great
previous
drive
final sector.
Through the final corner there as well.
Yeah,
sorry, Lee.
Really good drive. He loses a bit though. He loses a bit. Still loses a couple of a tenth to Helston. Let's say he lost. He's gone very wide into one. Yellow flags every time he comes to do a lap though. He's really getting balked badly.
Every time he seems to come up to any sort of competitor, he's usually getting white smoke from training brakes or yellow flags. So yeah, unfortunately, Dave. Like you said, Lee, there's a lot of potential there, but it's not paying off because of all the traffic, unfortunately, at the moment. And it looks like the two Torrent guys and Alex Cooper have just caught a lucky break here at the moment.
Well, Helston was pretty much matching his previous best lap time up to Sector 2 then. He got to Sector 3 and really trying to push the envelope, and he got slightly wide on the exit of the previous the second to last corner, and it basically kicked the rear end of the car out. And he's basically decided to pit instead, probably go for one last run now.
Oh, no! Ooh, that was nasty. Sorry, MP3 Castle on his lap. And he pretty much nearly got taken out by another car. It was parts on the... just before the quick right-hander in the first sector, come up to the first sector beam, and he very, very nearly got wiped out by, I think it's one of the Shrotons there. And he is currently... oh, he's a little bit up on his own time, and he's a tenth down... on Helston. Let's see if he's been able to carry the momentum for the second sector.
Ben Warren has improved now. He's gone up to P10 in the InnerVision team. He's coming across the line now. No, he's not. That's a replay. He's not on the hot lap at the moment. If he is, it's very slow. His sector's not improving. But Ben improving anyway up to P10, so good job from Ben Warren there.
Yeah, Petcaster has just come into the final sector now, and he's up on his own time. He's just half a tenth off Rickard. Let's see if he can have a better final sector than Rickard. He's going to come up to Teemu Toika though, and there's a lot of yellow flags again. Phil Cullen spun out the final corner. Oh, is he going to get a bit of a toe here from Teemu Toika? He is. Now, will this help him? No, it's not. He's still a tenth off his teammate, but goes to second.
Yeah.
Yeah, that locks out the front row now, doesn't it, for Torrent as well?
Good point, yes it does, and I'm sure they'll be pleased with that, especially with just 3 minutes and 40 seconds to go now. I'm not sure if there'll be much improvement from anyone.
Jack Nicholls heading across the line, that's 30.2, improves in time, but not a position. Oh, does he?
He does, Phil Cullen.
Yeah, he jumps up in front of Philip Cullen. So good job from Jack. Jack doing a good job there.
We've got P2 Petcaster as well. He's actually nearly 2 tenths up on his own time and half a tenth up on pole sitter Rickard Helston currently. Now he's just going down the sweeping right-hander and he'll hit the sector 2 beam and see if he's still improving. He is! 2 tenths up on his own time and
he's gone too wide though, he's run very wide. That's going to cost him a good tenth or two there. He'll have to really banzai his final sector now.
That's a shame, because that was a great lap up until then. Like you said, 2 tenths.
Dave as well. Sorry, Dave coming across the line now. Dave about to finish his latest hot lap. Improved slightly by half a tenth, but not a position. So he needs a bit more in that final sector, does Dave?
Yeah, once again, it's the final sector that's catching everyone out by the looks of it, because, yeah, just not able to do what he wants to in that final sector. He's struggling. He loses two tenths there every time. Oh, he's got the diff up, and he's just
Qatar,
unfortunately.
Qatar was very close to taking. They lost only half a tenth to Helsing in that final sector, so that mistake did cost him a lot. If he can do the same sectors again, because he was purple, sector one, sector two, then I think we could see Qatar on pole quite easily without that mistake. Because that definitely cost him two or three tenths.
Mm-hmm. He wasn't held up in the final sector either, so he didn't lose any time there, so it was solely due to that little off-track excursion.
Dave's backed off on his current lap, maybe had traffic or something, but Dave's backed off on his current lap he's on. He's got a minute to get to the line, so I presume he'll just go and give it one more banzai, see what he can do.
Alex Cooper messed up his lap on the final, second to last corner of the circuit.
Philip Cullen's also had a massive accident in the first sector. He was 2 tenths up, and unfortunately that's binned it. So that's Cullen's session over.
Oh, we just caught what looks like Grash there. Sorry if I pronounced that wrong. Just spun out of the exit of the last turn. That's his session over. He will finish in P6 there. Oh, no, he probably won't.
Well, there's one man who could take away, and that is Ben Warren in P10, actually, because he's... Maybe he might improve by that much, but he's 2 tenths up on his lap time at the moment. Well, tenth and a half up. He's run wide there, so maybe he's lost it now. But Ben had the pace to match his practice position, which was about P8. Could have actually got up to P7. So Ben Warren's doing a really good job. Sorry, at the moment.
Yeah, these front four haven't really made a significant improvement either. Looks.
Cooper had the chance to retake pole there. He was a tenth up on his own time in the middle sector, but he ran very, very wide on the exit of the fast chicane in the middle sector, and unfortunately I think that's going to ruin his bid, because he is quicker in his final sector generally. He's usually around 2 tenths faster, but I believe that's going to cost him more than he can gain. He may prove me wrong yet. He's coming around to the start and finish line now, but I don't believe he will have enough in hand to be able to retake pole. He's retaken second place, I was noticing. Or has someone left the server? Kassar's left the server, that's why.
Yeah, Kassar's left, but he didn't actually improve either there. Alex was to do his final that he would have wanted to.
Alright, just 10 seconds ago, we'll quickly run, well, we'll wait for the session to finish, then we'll run down your qualifying order. A few tweets we've had in: Ryan Walker backed Adam Rouse for the pole position, AJ Brown 2011 backed Martin O'Connor, and that's about it from all we've had. Oh, Phil Cullen, quality done for him, and he's got more speed but just didn't have a chance to hook it up, which is what we've seen for quite a few drivers today, especially Dave Cosmith. That's the session over then. Helston top spot, pole position 128.9.
Yeah, there's no one improving. Quite a few people start on track, about 10-11 cars, but there's no one massively improving. There's a big disappointment for me down the end of the grid. That definitely is Sam Miller. He's down in P20. Another guy you wouldn't expect to see down there, William Tringath. He's in 22nd, a good nearly 4 seconds off the pole time. Wupke Hoekstra, a man who was up in regularly top 10 last year at the end of the season in the Super Cup, he's down in P23. So some big surprises down the rear of the field anyway.
Yes, it's been a good qualifying session, this first qualifying obviously of the season. So it's the two Torren guys that look out the front of the grid. Rickard Helston on pole position with a 128.938. Pedicasa, his teammate, did a 128.978, so not really much between the minutes. Alex Cooper, he did a 129 dead, 0.050. Dave Cosmith next up on a 29.259. Jack Nicholls on a 30.260. So we're actually seeing there, Lee, quite a big jump between the top four and then to fifth place Jack Nicholls. That's a full second there, actually.
Yeah, and they're the four guys pretty much who we expect. Oh, well, I say there's three guys. Obviously, Dave's done a bit of a surprise there and got himself in the mix. For me personally, you obviously highlighted the fact that he's always up there. Now, Dave, to me, is always a man who wasn't always the quickest, but he's always there at the end. He's proved many times in the past, for example Monaco Super League last year, not always the quickest, doesn't have to be the quickest person, but ends up winning the race. So consistency sometimes pays more than top speed.
Indeed, and he has done very, very well. And it's, Jack Nicholls is on 130.260, Phil Cullen, he's done a 130.557, He's in sixth position. David Fiddock, he's done a 1:30.766 for No Fear Racing. We've got both Multiforce GP cars then. We've got Jason Muscat on a 1:30.852 and Terence Gresh on a 1:30.922. Then Ben Warren, he also did a 1:30.953, so it's quite close between those few drivers there. Only 0.2 putting 7th to 10th. And then we've got Scott Bennett, he did a 31.084. Martin O'Connor on a 31.100. Unfortunately, we should move to the next session, so I've lost all the times.
Yeah, one thing we have failed to notice, really, is that Motorforce, obviously Jason Muscat and Terence Gresh, are 8th and 9th on the grid. And they are obviously the defending champions from last year. They absolutely dominated the championship last year, pretty much. And they're 8th and 9th, so it just shows how it's swapped round this season at the moment.
Yes, very good point, actually. They took the constructors, and they did have a... They did have first and second place in the Drivers' Championship, of course. Both of those drivers moving up to Super League. But, yeah, that is a good point. Jason, who's dropped down from Super League, is a very quick driver. Hasn't found the speed today, unfortunately.
Just one quick point to make as well. I did notice there's quite a few different tyre compounds to choose from in this. And there's some people mentioning now the fact that they expect a lot of drivers to be on the Super Softs. Obviously, Helston, Kassar, Cooper. Possibly on the Super Softs, or maybe not in that case. We don't know. Maybe Dave's put the Supersofts on, that's why he looks suddenly closer to them, and people like Cullen, Fiddick on the Supersofts. There's a lot of strategy going on out there, because I don't believe in this series you have to actually do a mandatory pit stop. So, obviously a lot of drivers could be fueling it up, doing for a one stop, a zero stop. We obviously don't know what the strategy is going to be. I mean, at the moment, if you're on Supersofts, with these sort of tyre wears, like it was last year, you're looking at maybe a 1-2 stop. Some drivers might be on a harder compound trying to go zero stops. So, you know, the people who have qualified down 7th and 8th, you know, the people you wouldn't expect to see down there, like Jason Muscat, maybe he's got something up his sleeve. Maybe he's going for a zero stop and he's going to come through later on in the race.
Strategy is everything. It'll be interesting to see what these front few cars do and when they decide to stop, and obviously what tyres they take on again.
One thing I'm going to highlight from pre-season is the fiasco over traction control and whether that would be allowed in what aspect. I believe it's allowed on setting medium now. How much of a difference does that make in reality in regards to making these cars easier or the loss of time?
Well, for me personally, traction control obviously is something I haven't used for a long time, and I know a lot of drivers depend on it. But the thing is, if you really go for it and practice, it's just as easy without it. It just requires slightly more concentration at first, because you're not used to the rear end snapping out and obviously being controlled for you. And obviously, with these cars not having the tyre warmers, as Nick's already pointed to earlier, you don't get the warm tyres when you come straight out of the pit lane. So the start of this race is going to be extremely fun, I would say, because the tyres are going to be stone cold on the start and the formation lap. And it wouldn't surprise me if we see many casualties on lap one spinning out purely because the tyres are so cold. And that's the only reason why it will be more difficult. Once the tyres are up to temperature, there's very little difference between having traction control on and traction control off.
Also, I'm not 100% sure of if there is a weight penalty with the traction control as well. Some mods and cars actually have a weight penalty if you add the apply traction control. Because sometimes, in some circumstances, it can help lap time. But as Lee alluded to there before, it's once you've got used to it, it feels like you're using traction control with your right foot anyway. You know, your right foot becomes traction control rather than depending on an electronic system to do it for you. So rather than just, you know, mashing the throttle and getting back on it, you can actually control it, and you control the slide, you control the rear tyres. You maintain the tyre temperature, you try and decrease wear. And this is all things that most of these guys would have done throughout the pre-season. I'm sure, what for myself personally and Lee has done extensively for the Super League mod also.
Yeah, that is one big benefit. Well, there's two big benefits, actually, of not using traction control. One, you get a faster lap time, because not using traction control is always faster than using traction control. That is guaranteed with anything. Once you learn it, you will become faster without traction control, because you can modulate the throttle more. You can you basically get more acceleration out of the corners. You control how fast the car comes out of the corner rather than the engine, like Nick said, and the electronics. And the second and probably the biggest advantage of that is the fact that you get less tyre wear, because you're not leaning on the edge as much on a false edge. Let's say when you come out the corner with a right foot planted and with traction control helping you, you don't actually know if the back end's stepping out or not, because it doesn't tell you. When you control it with your right foot, suddenly you start realising, oh, hang on, I need to modulate my throttle usage a bit more here, and stop leaning on the tyres as much.
I think that was quite well highlighted, especially in, I believe, 2006, Jenson Button, when he... Jenson Button was always one of the people, when in the wet conditions, he'd always turn down his traction control, so he could feel more of the track, and he knew more of the track and where to find the grip. And I think that's when you really do find your wet weather specialists. And you know, Jenson Button is one of those type of drivers. Michael Schumacher, another one. And you really tap into that sort of area where you control the throttle more so, and you're able to gain the grip and the feedback from the track more so than if you are just slamming on the throttle, as Lee said, and essentially spinning up the rear tyres, but without you knowing, because the electronics take over.
Yeah, at the moment we've got Muscat top of the standings in the warm-up so far. Obviously, the guys who took pole, second, third, fourth have yet to set a time. Muscat currently top of the standings. Obviously now we're on full race spec, everyone's getting used to the setup again. Obviously compared to qualifying, which was on lowish fuel, but with race settings applied. Now we're on the full fuel, the proper compound of tyres, obviously what they're going to be running. This will show up now. We're looking good for race. I presume the usual names will be up there if they're on the respective tyre compounds from before. But Muscat, a lot higher than he's been all practice and qualifying so far anyway. And they've got to do something, basically, in Multiforce. I mean, they're down in the top end of the top 10 and nearly got knocked out of the top 10 if a few people have improved. So Multiforce have got to respond if they're going to defend this championship from the start, because at the moment you can't see past the top four clearing off at the beginning of this race, and the rest of the field fighting for the scraps of 5th, 6th and 7th.
Yeah, and it will be interesting to see if those drivers just behind the guys that have obviously qualified very, very highly and with very quick times as well, if they are able to improve in terms of race pace and their race pace allowing them to be closer to the front runners. Jason Muscat was one of those people last year, maybe not always the outright quickest in a qualifying session, but we often saw in Super League Jason Muscat do very well come race, unless he had a disconnection. So if he has the advantage of that, he usually is quite a decent racer. But I am just watching Muscat, and I'm seeing Helston catch him quite handsomely at the moment. So Helston's got a lot of pace in that Torrent car.
Yeah, it's a substantial amount as Terence Gresh goes to P1 and 31.8. And these times obviously are a lot slower because of the fuel load and the race setups as such. But obviously you've got to expect that people like Helston and that can go at least a second, you know, possibly into the 30s, maybe even the 29s on race pace. And at the moment the gaps, it looks like a lot of people are struggling to readapt to these race fuels, because look at the lap times at the moment. I mean, the top 13 is separated by 7 seconds, so there's obviously a lot of learning and relearning, readjusting going out there, readaptation. And the thing that's going to be key to me is strategy on this one, obviously. Kassar's now going to 30.1, so we are going to be in the 29s on race fuel, no doubt about it. That's more like what we were looking for.
By 1.7 seconds, that's impressive.
Yeah, that is very impressive. And obviously you'd expect that Alex Cooper will be able to do the same. He's gone third at the moment, but obviously been held up. And also Helston. But the key for me is the strategy. The strategy is going to be key, because the tyres in this mod take such a beating. The actual corner speed you can carry in this mod are crazy compared to last year, and the tyres are going to be taking a beating. Anyone who has started on the super soft compound, for me, is really going to struggle to make this work, because it's so difficult to look after tyres in this mod. And one of the reasons is what we've been discussing a minute ago, lack of traction control, because, you know, where do you... where do you place the throttle in your foot position to modulate it? This is things that you should have tested, obviously, if you really want to win the race. But in race conditions, it's different, because you're going for it, you're attacking. It's very hard to keep focus and think, right, I've got to look after my tyres. Like Muscat, for example, if he was on a one-stop or a zero-stop, It's very difficult for him to think, right, just keep your head, you know, don't go charging after the others, let them get away. And when the pit stops work out, I'll end up in front. It's a very difficult thing to be able to control your emotions and see people disappearing into distance, but sometimes that's the best way. Car coming around again, will he take it further? He does, 29.6 on race fuel. Well, we presume that's race fuel. That's only half a second off the quality. I mean, in fact, that time would have put him fifth, I believe, on the grid. Fifth or sixth on the grid. So he's very, very quick in race fuel. And obviously, anyone else has, no one else has yet to show this yet. Dave doing some practice starts on the grid. Helston coming around to complete his second flying lap, which has been a proper clear lap. And he only does 30.6. I don't know if he got held up there or not, but that's not a very quick lap time. Although his middle sector was a good half, well, 6 tenths slower. You can imagine that he'd be in 29s as well. And there's no one else behind them that's really looking like they're going to challenge. I mean, Terence Gresh, he was up in 9th, I believe, in qualifying, 9th or 10th. Currently 3rd in the race warm-up. Dan Miller looking more competitive in the race warm-up than he did in the qualifying and practice, up in P8. But again, I don't think these times are really representative because it looks like a lot of people have been really struggling to readapt to this. Dave's down in 18th on a 201, so obviously he's just been cruising around trying a few things out. A few people in the server house are having issues with the joining and leaving and things like that. Which is a shame for them. Hopefully they'll get them sorted. We don't want to see anyone with any issues.
No, not at all. And as you were rightly said, obviously Petter gone into the 29s, 29.6. 4 seconds actually in front of his teammate Rickard Helston as well. But Rickard is actually on a lap at the moment. I wonder if he'll improve as he comes across the line as warm-up ends. He's just driving for the line now. He'll be last, I think, one last over the line. There we go. 2 tenths quicker than his teammate.
Wow. Well, Dave having a nightmare session again. He's pinged 700 for some reason, so he's really struggling with that, because I've noticed he's parking up at the side of the track a few times. Looks like he's lagging badly for some reason. Hopefully he'll get that sorted, because Dave's had a pretty much a nightmare so far. But the surprise so far is Terence Gresh up in P3 for Multiforce. Suddenly Multiforce looking a bit more competitive in the race warm-up. Although some time off, we don't know what Helston and Cassar are running. I presume they're on the softest compounds, you know, basically going for the more aggressive strategy. But you look at Motorforce, they're up in P3, P5, they're looking a lot better now.
Yeah, obviously, just because who are just in behind, they looks like they've picked up their pace a little bit as well, so you could see something here from some of these guys. 2.4 off, I think we'll probably see the top four guys check out pretty early on.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, there's a few people having issues and worried about this change to the race session, hence a crash to desktop. So hopefully, fingers crossed, we'll get through this fine, because there are some issues in this slightly, unfortunately.
Yeah, both, well, all the mods this year seem to be quite heavy mods, and they are obviously having quite some effect. Hopefully they'll iron all the problems out before the race start. If not, I'm sure things...
Told Dave that he's lagging badly, actually, because he needs to know about that, because there's going to be a big accident with him at the start.
Sorry about that, guys. Just a little bit of a thing to deal with. Right, we didn't get a chance to do a quick lap with Ben, but we will do it in just a minute. And Lee, I think you're going to voice over that for us.
Yeah, that's fine.
Alright, we'll do that during the race at some point. I've heard a talk on the server about zero-stop strategy, mainly of the middle pack guys. So, obviously, them wanting to try something, maybe they'll get a little bit of a jump on the top competitors.
Yeah, we've got a big issue here with this server at the moment. There's now about 3 or 4 different people in under the same name, and there's a lot of issues going on at the moment. People are leaving, rejoining. When someone joins, someone gets kicked, things like that. I think we're going to struggle to get this one going, to be honest.
That's going to be unfortunate. I'm trying to look what and see what you mean, but I can't see anything on my live races in a minute. But I know that there's some people who have complained about some errors tonight, and we ourselves have had some errors rather. We've managed to get them fixed, and it's been a bit stable now. But yeah, I can see problems that people are having. Never had to reschedule a race before, so hopefully it doesn't happen here.
Yeah, I think a lot of people are going to come out this disappointed because, I mean, myself, I've had no issues so far on this server, and I know Nick's been in a long time, you've been, so hopefully we'll get underway, but it looks like a lot of people are really struggling with this, and it's the same issues we had in the Super League during testing.
I think it largely depends on compute spec, which is unfortunate. Yeah. We've had to install patches and set priorities and stuff like that, so maybe just fewer drivers got to get that sorted, and maybe we'll just be able to get away with it. But it looks as if most people are in the server now.
The fact is, and the biggest thing is, last year obviously we had smaller grids for sure. Obviously the mob was less dependent, definitely, but we had smaller grids. This year the grid sizes have just gone huge, you know. And obviously people are struggling to run 30 cars at a time, which is understandable. Obviously no one's expected that much. So it's not really the admin's fault or the league's fault. It's just a bit of a surprise, you know what I mean, to have this many people in. So
yeah, it is a point. It's not like people are running it on ancient PCs. It's just the sheer amount of people and the demandingness of this mod is massive. So it's a problem. Obviously, I was in a game the other day for a little while before my computer blue screen, but I'm running some very decent specs and I was having FPS drop something, so it's just very, very demanding this year. And with Formula Challenge as well, it was less demanding, but still certain parts of tracks that tended to lag just a little bit.
It's a shame because I think we're going to be able to watch a brilliant race here. I really think this is going to be good fun to watch. Hopefully we'll get underway, but at the moment it's looking very doubtful for quite a few people. I mean, myself, even, like you say, I mean, your specs, my specs are fine, you know what I mean, personally, I'm quite happy with my specs, but I joined this session, and I struggled as well on the main straight. There was cars coming down the main straight, and it was like, whoa, where's my FPS gone? So, I can imagine, you know, I really sympathise with some of the other people out there who've got lower-end spec machines, because it's really going to struggle.
I think it's the quality of the deliveries. I think they're running a very, very high spec. And of course, you put 25, 26 of them all combined together, you're going to get for some interesting times like we're finding now. I think they may have to adjust these at some stage.
Technically, the grid should only be around 24, I think, 12 teams and two drives apiece. So maybe just a few people can disperse. I might have that completely wrong, it might be in 14 teams. Yeah, we've got 28 people listed in the server at the moment. It's just weird. We've got people who are reporting when certain people join, they get kicked out. So it's a very weird one. We thank everyone for staying with us while we just get sorted. We've just restarted warm-up, so we'll wait until we get a few more drivers who are having a few problems in. Yeah, you can let us know what you think of this event so far through Twitter at GPVWC, just to let us know. Anything else to report? I'll see if we can get Cara on track so we can do a quick track guide. Looks like a few drivers are, so we might get a chance to do that yet.
I'm just looking through now, there's a couple of drivers going out on track, but we've got Sam Miller out there, we've got Mr. Fiddick out there as well. There's a few drivers just about to start some hot laps, but at the moment I think they're just struggling to sort this these connection issues out more than anything. Cam's not in good shape, he's off again, he's really got a lot of understeer in that car, then oversteer on the exit of corners. Sam Miller, I know he's having troubles with the game like as well, but he's really not looking too handy at the moment.
No, I think he's also a bit surprised about his pace and even potentially his race pace at the moment, which is quite surprising for someone that was very quick last year in Super League.
One who was very quick in Super Cup as well, of course, he very inconsistent in terms of attendance, but he was actually very quick when he did turn up. Few pole positions, maybe even a win here or there, and same in Super League. I know he definitely got a podium a few times, I remember, in the post-race press conference. Yeah, he might be having trouble with his wheel. I had the wheel that he's currently got, and that it was definitely riddled with problems, especially when it was got used quite a lot. So, yeah, that might be a source of problems.
There's quite a few drivers out of track now.
Yeah, I'm just watching Terence Gresh at the moment. It's like the third fastest time in the warm-up session just before this. He's just come around to the halfway point, so in a minute we'll go on board with him, and hopefully he'll get a clean lap in and you'll be able to commentate over the top, Lee.
Yeah, he's pretty surprising in warm-up. It's like you say, being quite quick. He did a good qualifying session. So let's see, well, he's coming around to the start line now, it's got a bit of traffic in front, so hopefully he won't get impeded. Anyway, now heading into turn 16. Don't believe this corner has a name. Just turn 16, heading onto the main straight now. Quite a long straight, the only reasonable overtaking place at Albert Park. Probably the highest top speed you get to, apart from the back straight. Heading down into the Brabham chicane with the Jones exit. Nice apex there from Terence. Gets on the power nice and early. Fifth up to sixth gear. Using all the track available to him and the kerbs on the exit as well. Now heading down into the Whiteford. Quite a tight right under this in the deceiving corner. The best is keep it tight, which he didn't do unfortunately. Turn 4 again unnamed, I believe. Same with turn 5. In fact, there's a lot of corners on this track because it's a street circuit. I don't believe actually have names or official names. The same with turn 6 we're approaching now under the always hard to spot the braking zone there because of the shadows, and usually it's quite bumpy as well on entry. Right hander now, which is flat in the dry, in the wet it's a nightmare. Heading down now into Clark, the Clark chicane. Tricky little chicane, you've got to get on the power nice and early to get a good exit for this back straight, because you lose lap time obviously, the longer you're off the throttle the less lap time you gain. Heading down now into the fast turn 11 and 12 chicane. This is very, very quick, especially in these cars. I mean, the speed they're pulling for there is crazy. Terence gets a slight bit of oversteer, snap oversteer on the exit. We've got a car off at the start of the track there, so this has been a chaotic lap to say this. Now into the interesting bit, Ascari. Ascari, quite a tight corner again. You've got to use all the track on the exit, as Terence does nicely there. Into Stewart, turn 14. Then into the final corner, using all the track on the exit again, Prost. Hard on the brakes, keep it left, keep it tight to left, which Terence doesn't do unfortunately, maybe struggling with the tyres there, into the final corner, turn 16, hard on the power onto the main straight. Decent lap from Terence here, looks like he's going to go P1 with this lap time on a 32.1 just from Muscat. So thank you Terence for that, great lap.
Yeah, and it's quite rare that we get an unimpeded lap when we go on board, so very, very good, actually. Interesting point raised on Twitter by Lewis Redshaw. This time last year, Bartlevoss was on pole by second. So that just shows the level of talent we've got this year. Four drivers within a second feature.
Yeah, I mean, DeVos, really, when he came in last year, it was DeVos and Redshaw, wasn't it? Obviously, obviously Lewis is watching now. He's in Super League this year. So, well, they both stepped up, haven't they? DeVos and Redshaw both stepped up this year to the Super League. Obviously, now, like you said, the new rule's not allowed to race in this anymore. But they really were the dominant force last year, with the odd time Lochnowsky looking in there as well. But again, he's, I believe, in Super League this year.
Yes, yes, he is.
But yeah, obviously Redshaw and Malte Force with Bart DeVos, they were really the dominant force. And at the moment, in this warm-up session, they're the dominant force again. They're currently first and second, Muscat and Gress. Equally matched teammates by the looks of it, because obviously they qualified together as well, 8th and 9th, I believe. And they were less than a couple of tenths apart then, and this warm-up's exactly the same, half a tenth apart. So it looks like we're about to go to the race now anyway, I believe. So let's hopefully get this underway. Yeah, here we go. We've advanced the race session, so let's see how we go.
Hopefully, we've had a bit of tip from someone else on how to film the race starts. Very quickly then, as they are all making their way to track, can we get a race prediction from both of you? Race win prediction.
I'll let Nick go first.
Petter.
Nick's going with Petter Kassar then. Honest, after his qualifying pace and his warm-up pace, it's hard not to go in, but obviously Helston, I believe, won my bet for qualifying.
He did, yes.
In which case, I'm 50p up already, so Rickard Elston's going to be my race prediction as well. It's very cyber. Now, this is the key, see, this is the key. The cars now are on very, very, very low tyre pressures and temperatures, and this is where I expect some of the troubles to be, especially on the first lap. And it looks like we'll probably have a restart anyway, because we've got a few guys who are not in the correct grid position, unfortunately, so the disaster continues.
Yeah, that always happens when people start getting booted down, leaving and joining, and things like that, but unfortunately, that's the way we have to go.
Yeah, this won't continue, because obviously there's cars out of position, things like that. It'd probably be a quick fix restart, hopefully. I think they know what they're doing. So, I say that, and so far, no one's really doing anything about it.
There's a bit of chaos. Elston's
maintaining
well.
The gap. Obviously, Elston's up front, and Kassar, the Torrent Motorsports 1-2 grid lockout up front. Very smart looking cars as well, I must say. The IP Forge Torrent Motorsports team looking like they're going to display a show of dominance here. But at the moment, people are calling for a restart, and I don't actually disagree with their opinion.
Well, it looks like most people are in the correct position. By the looks of it, I'm just scrolling through. Ben Warren should be 10th, I thought. We've got O'Connor there. So it looks like there are a few people in out of position, unfortunately, so that hopefully will get resolved shortly.
It's Mr. Cullen, he's up to one of them.
Fiddick is way down as well. He's in 22nd, he should be about 9th. Yeah, Phil Cullen's right at the very back, and he was what? He was 6th, I believe.
Yeah, Fiddick, obviously, 22nd, he was, like you say, 6th, and obviously, Philip Cullen as well, 27th, so they've been penalised heavily through this, and it's not really their fault, to be honest. Then again, it's not really the league's fault as well, in some respects, and obviously the admin's fault, so it looks like we're going to continue here, actually. I think everyone's pretty much just got on with it. So as Elston comes around now, leading the pack, trying desperately to get temperature into these tyres, you can see him smoking up the rears, same with Kassar, obviously they're well trained in this, they're two experienced guys, really can work, they really should be able to work together to try and win this thing, actually. Cooper's the man who's got to do the work, and Dave Carr-Smith, but you can see him desperately trying to weave, trying to get some temperature into these tyres, because they're so cold right now. I mean, Helston, right up to the line, he's spinning the rears up.
Yeah, he's got a very long time to wait until those back cars file into their order, so he really does have to make sure he's as warm as he can.
I think they are waiting for to see what the race starts like before possibly restarting it.
Yeah, it might be a bit hectic. The rule is, 5 cars out, that warrants a restart. Over anything else, or if lap 2 begins, basically, then there will be no restart.
And it looks like we've got Mal McKee starting from pit lane.
Yeah, he stopped on the outlet for some reason, so...
There we go then. 2, 3, 4, and the 5th light is up for the first round of the Super Cup this year. And we're away and we're racing. A good start by Hellström there. Oh no, not very good start. He's weaving around a bit, but doesn't lose position, actually. He's first as they head around the line. It looks like his teammate's not had as much of a good start then.
It's a big pile-up in the midfield, though. We've got cars off, there's Bennett off, O'Connor's off, Bennett's off again. Cullen's made up many places, there's quite a few cars involved in an accident. Fiddick's been taken off in turn one, Hoekstra's off in the gravel with no front and rear wing. Got Toiker off as well, Williamson out, bulging out at the back of the field, so a big mess at the back of the field.
Yeah, Helston actually did have it. He got a lot of wheels put to spin initially, but got good grip and good traction. But it was Alex Cooper that made the jump. Alex Cooper moved up.
Tringas off. Massive accident into turn two. Tringas off. He got no wheels on the car. There's been a big shunt into the third corner. Unfortunately, there's lots and lots of cars out in the midfield. We're basically, when you go from P14 onwards, there's no one there. So we've lost like 10, 15 cars in the first few corners. That's crazy.
this will warrant a restart if they all DNF. We have 26, 24, 20, well, 27s. It looks like we have a few drivers out already.
It looks like we've still got some drivers going, though, from the Fiddick backwards. I think we're pretty much struggling for that 16th backwards. So Koivunen, Schroepen, Woodwist, Toika, Hoekstra, McKee, Belgian, O'Connor, Tringas and Williamson all appear to have either had issues or coming into pit lane, I would have thought, for repairs. But at the front, it's Rickard Helston. He leads lap one, and he's got Alex Cooper about a second
behind
him.
Because they're going for it, and they just hit the front wing there. They just hit the debris on the track.
Yeah, there's a huge amount of debris on the track. Hopefully, neither of them got a puncture from that, because that was pretty nasty.
I think Cooper hit it pretty hard, and he's got in the slipstream. He's got Kassar right in his slipstream now, heading down to turn three, side by side. Cooper trying to defend on the inside, does a good job, but runs too wide.
He's gone
straight off into the gravel, and that's basically putting it up now for a Toro Motorsports 1-2.
Kept it off the wall though, so he's good. He could be able to catch him at this point, very early on in the race, of course, and no damage. We'll see what his strategy is like.
He really needed to do that though.
I'm just going to see if he heavy brakes. Yeah, heavy braking, he's still okay, so he hasn't got a puncture. That front wing hasn't got a puncture. I wonder if he actually got damage to the suspension though instead. I wonder if that's what maybe that front wing did. I also saw a rear wing at turn three, so. And the two Multiforce guys behind have actually caught the CSG car pretty quickly. Got bulging on the side of the track there as well.
Dave's lost a lot of time, on the start there. He dropped down to P7 at the start. He had a bad start, and Jack Nicholls got past him. He's actually repassed Jack Nicholls now, and he's right on the back of the two Motorforce guys. There's quite a bit of traffic around at the moment. Hoekstra down the side. As Gresh gets passed by Muscat goes inside of Gresh.
Dave falls through.
Dave, very opportunistic there from Dave. He takes a position there, up to P5, and he's in prime position now to try and get Muscat. But the one thing we've got to remember is if these two guys, the Motorforce GP guys, are on different strategies, they're really handily placed at the moment, because they've gained 5 or 6 places off the start. As Dave gets sideways off the final corner there, and that's let Gresh back in his slipstream. So Dave's going to have to defend into turn one now, but he's got good straight line speed there. He's still receiving slipstream from Muscat as we're into turn one, and it's status quo.
Dave's
lost it.
He clipped the inside curb, and it's spinning round. We saw something similar from this.
Jack Nicholls going for P5. Sorry, Jack's taken P5 into turn two. But he runs slightly wide on the exit. Can he keep it? No, Gresh sneaks back through. So Nicholls looking racy in P6 as well. We've got another car off into this today. Who's that?
Looks like a DB.
Dave's round again! The Univision car from Dave Carsmith's round again at turn three. So he's really struggling with rear end grip. Lee, exactly as you said, these rear tyres. That's Timmy Toiker off there as well at turn four. So these tyres are absolutely hell in the first few laps. And unfortunately, Dave, after.
Nicholls once again, the side by side. Nicholls once again, side by side. Sorry, Nick, there's so much going on. Nicholls again trying to get by Gresh. He's in a perfect prime position now. He's got a lot more top speed than Gresh. And he's done it this time, surely. He won't get back past now. He's passed him twice on this lap and not got away. Now he's done it. Nicholls into P5 with opportunistic overtaking there. Good job from Jack.
Yeah, great work there from Jack. And this has just allowed the guys at the front to just pull away now. Muscat was clear, pretty much, and he's been able to try to start honing on Alex Cooper. And Cooper, in turn, he's five seconds behind Petter Kasser, and Petter is 2.6 seconds behind his teammate Rickard Helston. But this currently is a Torrent 1-2, as a lot of people predicted. And let's see if Alex is able to regain that loss he ran on at turn two.
Dave Casper and Ben Warren have had the most disastrous start to a race I've ever seen. I mean, they're both down in P13-14. Ben's just spun in front of Dave again. So really bad luck for them guys. Look at this. We've got Nicholls. Point Rising up in P7. It's crazy what's happened in this race. There's just cars decimating out the field. Nicholls has actually passed Muscat, I believe. No, he hasn't. He's got Gresh right all over him again. So Gresh suddenly found some speed from somewhere.
No, it was a mistake by Jack Nicholls. Ran too deep into turn three, and Gresh got all over the back of him again. And that's really allowed Gresh to close up the gap, as you can see there.
Yeah, Dave Carr-Smith's really struggling now. I think he was trying to get a little bit too overexcited over the curbs with still cool tyres, and that's what spun him out a couple of times.
I think he knew he needed to do that though, because he had a terrible start. He lost three places off the start line as Gresh gets very close again to Nichols. Now I personally believe Gresh has got more pace in his car at the moment than he can use, but we don't know what tyre compound he's on, that's the thing. They're looking quite handily placed, the MotoGPs, anyway, if they are on. And Cassage, has he made a mistake there? Yeah, Cassage just made a mistake as well in the final sector. So to me, if these guys are on super soft, this is when they're going to start showing now. It's a couple of laps in, they're really going to start to hurt now, because these fuel loads eat your tyres. You're going to have struggle. You know, you're really going to struggle to put the power down, things like that. And Gresh is right on the back of Nichols.
Because Cooper's closed on Casa quite significantly.
Yeah, it was the final sector. I think Cassar got a bit of wheel spin out the second to last corner, which shows he's struggling to put the power down. The lap times are good. They're in the low 30s at the moment. The fastest man actually at the moment is Helston, I believe, on a 30.1. He's just pretty much driving away at the moment.
Yeah, Helston's had a bit of a dream start, really. 30.1 his fastest time, with Caster's done a 30.412 and Cooper a 30.668. So Helston's actually half a second quicker on the fastest lap compared to Cooper. So
we have a new Justin Wilson in the field. It's Philip Cullen. He's come from the very back of the grid, and he's now P7, and he's got P5, P6, he's got them all in sight. He's still got a podium in sight here, because he's lapping pretty quick as well. He's taking chunks of time out of Gresh and Nichols, and Muscat for that as well. So, Philip Cullen, awesome job, mate. I mean, to get from the back of the grid, he's up to P7 now. He's absolutely flying.
Other than the first three, he's the only other driver that's dipped to 31s. So he's got a handy bit of pace for the midfielders. The front three are all in the 30s, but everyone else seems to be in the 32s, other than Cullen, who is in the 31s. And as it's a high 31 currently, but this lap looks like it's been pretty decent as well. And especially when Cassar
lapping quickly,
like this.
Cassar lapping quickly.
Fastest lap of the race. 130.0 is the fastest lap of the race for Peter Cassar.
So his tyres must be hanging on still. There's nothing wrong with that grip. And Cooper in P3. All but matching the leaders anyway. He's about half a second shy. So Cooper now, he's settled down after his misdemeanors at the start there, unfortunately. He is settling down now, but he knew at the start, along with Dave, obviously, he knew that these Torrent guys are really quick and they're going to drive away from the field, as we predicted. And that's what's happening. They know they've got to do everything to try and get after him. So they were trying so hard early on to really, you know, get after these leaders and try and split them, which Cooper actually did. Cooper got a brilliant start and he actually split the Torrents. But unfortunately, it didn't last.
Gresh is all over the back of Jack Nichols now. He was very, very close just a minute ago, but he had a back off, so he's got a bit more of a gap than he had just a few corners ago now. But he is faster, definitely faster than Jack Nichols. It's just a matter of time now.
The problem is, though, he's quick over a lap, definitely, there's no doubt about it. You can see through the corners he gains so much and in the braking zones. But look at the straight, look at Jack Nichols' top speed. He's nearly 12.
So much traffic, sorry Lee, Rickard's just come up against three cars and he's lost a heap of time to Petter. He's really struggling to get through this back traffic. There's Woodwiss, Schroten and Koivunen. He's really struggled to get through this. The gap's now at the front, now down to 3.5 seconds.
The only saving grace for, obviously, Rickard is once he gets through this. Kassar's got to lap the same cars. Rickard is, getting very held up there by Koivunen. And luckily, no accident involved there. But now Kassar's got all three cars to defend to get past, whereas Helston's managed to do that cleanly. Well, it lost a bit of time, obviously, like you said, but at least he's got through clean.
Worst possible parts. Well, Woodwiss has pulled over, but he's up against Schroten and Koivunen. Now, them two are battling. He's caught them in probably the worst part of the track. So hopefully this won't compromise him too much. But Petter is certainly been beneficiary of these cars passing each other, and Schroten and Koivunen going side by side as well. This is going to get interesting for Petter.
Well, obviously the benefit to this is Helston and Cassar. I mean, what's the big advantage they've got?
There's
Cassar, it's very old up. So you see, it's equal. It's worked out pretty much equal, because now Schroten needs to move over. Yeah, he has, and he's eased off. Good job, Schroten. Now, Koivunen, will he move over after the chicane? Obviously, he's going to catch him on the exit of this chicane, you'd think. Probably be in the slipstream. Yeah, he is. Now, Koivunen, do your job, mate, and move over. He's seen the blue flags, he should be staying to the left if he's going to... Yep, and there we go, he eases off. Very good job there from Koivunen and Schroten. Obviously they're battling as well, so they can't just see position easily. But the thing, what's the biggest advantage Cassar and Helston have got over the rest of the field? The fact that they're 1-2, and the teammates, they can work together through this. They can say, right, it's not Alex Cooper catching me, it's my teammate. They're not going to battle each other that hard for the win. They can just take this nice and easy and cruise to the end, basically, because they've got very good speed.
Yeah, and in this process, Phil Cunningham has actually caught up to the back of Terence Gresh now as well, so it's pretty much Nichols, Gresh, and Cullen, 5th, 6th, and 7th, battling. Just going back through the field a little bit more, Fiddock, he's progressed himself into 12th place. Rick Scott's actually not doing too badly, another CSG car, he's in 10th place. And Dave Carr-Smith, he is down in 15th now. So his teammates got back past him, and so has Pestovs.
This little pack of Nichols, Gresh and Cullen, they're not battling each other at the moment, and they're actually Backmocker's got in the way there, but Nichols managed to get through him. They're actually catching onto the back of Jason Muscat now, who's sitting in fourth, so it won't be long before we see a little bit of a four-way battle for a fourth position, actually.
Yeah, I was just about to say that. I'm glad you noticed that as well, because although, like you say, Cullen's caught up to the back of Gresh and Nichols, it almost looks like Nichols is forming a train, but he isn't actually, he's catching Muscat. The only reason that Nichols didn't lose a position to Gresh early on in the last few laps is that he's got so much more top speed. He's almost 12-13 mile an hour faster in a straight line than the guy behind him, Gresh. Cullen now on the back of Gresh, and another shout out I want to make is Boyd Brighton. He's up in P8 at the moment. He's lapping very consistently, and he's actually matching Cullen and the group in front. In fact, I believe, yeah, he's taking bits of lap time out of them here and there when they start battling. So good job from him as well.
Yeah, absolutely. That's good. Good pace there from Bryson, and Alex Cooper still making his way past a few backmarks here. He's just gone past Koivunen, and he'll have Schroeder on next to navigate round with Sam Miller as well. So, yeah, Sam Miller's just not having a good one at the moment here, Lee.
He got caught up in the action at the start, to be fair. Apologies again, Adam.
Right.
We're not coordinating this very well, are we? Miller, he got caught up in an accident at the start, unfortunately, as well. I think that didn't help him. Obviously, he's had some issues. But, no, his pace has been pretty abysmal, to be honest. Cooper's obviously in that chain traffic now that the leaders were in a minute ago. But the problem is, they've already passed it, and Cooper is about to catch Schroeder and gets very close to wiping his front wing out there. But he's already 12 seconds behind Helston, so... basically, the Torrents are in a world of their own at the moment, as we predicted.
Boyd Bryson is up in 7th after a spin from what I believe was Phil Cullen. Yes, it was. Phil Cullen is now up in 9th behind Adam Rouse.
If all these closed up, it'd be a bit hasty, wouldn't it? Because we'd have, what, 5 or 6 cars battling for 4th place, because at the moment Muscat looks like he's losing pace. If anything, he is. Muscat. In fact, if Muscat gets gets a sniff of slipstream, which he has, we should really look at Nichols now, because Nichols is on the back of Muscat. Muscat's lost pace. Nichols has settled down, and all of a sudden he's got less than 7 tenths between them. And Nichols is a good... Well, actually, the speed's not too much variable between these. It's not as variant between these two. It's only about 5 or 6 mile an hour. But with the slipstream, that's going to quite easily equate to 10. So Nichols, if he gets a sniff of slipstream from Muscat, he's going to be looking at 4th place quite quickly. And Muscat pretty leery on the braking there, into the final chicane there.
We've got a battle developing for 8th position now, and Phil Cullen is inside Adam Rouse at the final turn. It actually makes it stick, a bit of a bounce off the curb there, but actually does manage to stay in front. Adam Rouse being caught a bit unawares there.
Yeah, Cullen, good manoeuvre there to get back into P8, and also he's not actually lost that much time. He only lost, 7 seconds in his little spins, 6 or 7 seconds. So he can quite easily make that back up if they start battling, which they are now. If you look, Nichols is right on the back of Muscat, and the speed he clawed back up on him there was crazy. And if he can hold this gap he's got now through the rest of this lap, he's looking at passing him on the back straight quite comfortably. He'll just breeze past him, and there's nothing Muscat will be able to do about it. In fact, he's in the slipstream now. He might even be having a look now into the next chicane, because look at the speed he's gaining. He pulls out to signal his intentions. Bit of a dummy there from Nichols to say, look, I'm here. But I guarantee on this next straight, he'll be past him before the end of it, because he's in the slipstream now. He's going up for the gears. And look at this, he'll just drive around the outside of him. There we go. Muscat launches back up the inside, side by side for the chicane, and Muscat holds onto it with some really nice driving there, actually. Managed to avoid a Button and Massery incident last year there. They drove side by side for one of the fastest chicanes that you'll see on a racetrack. Very good driving there from both of them. Nichols is still in prime position, though, because, to me, Muscat's struggling. Muscat's tyres have gone or something, because all of a sudden, his lap times have dropped by a good 2 or 3 seconds. And Nichols isn't lapping any quicker than he was before. He's still in prime position now, as they enter the main straight. in the slipstream again. He's going to be past him this time, surely, if he gets the optimal line for turn one. Muscat doesn't defend. It's pointless, really, because he's already passed him. Nick, oh, and the touch. Muscat outbreaks himself there. Muscat spawned. Muscat's lost it. That was silly from Muscat. He was trying to defend the position there. It wasn't going to happen. He basically outbraked himself. I think Nicol's speed caught him out slightly. He's dropped down to P7 now. P8, because Cullen's got... Ooh, close to Cullen. To the wall. Cullen's up the inside of him. Now he's past him. Has Nicol's got damage?
No, he just spun off. Well, there was a car and he had to avoid on the entrance of turn 3. Just a spun car sitting there and let's go round the outside we saw on stream. No damage though.
Well, the one thing this has done, it's made it tasty for us because we've got P4, 5, 6, 7, 8, up to P9, all within, what's that, is that 5 seconds? Yeah, 5 seconds of each other, the top from P4 to P9. So we're going to have a really tasty
scrap. Shout out there for Rousey, actually, who has gained a lot of time. He's, you know, he was in ninth position. He's caught these guys that have been battling. So, yeah, big shout out to Adam Rouse there. 32.452 is his quickest time currently, but he has caught, he's nearly on the back of Muscat already.
The two leaders still, I mean, they're just so consistent at the moment, it's crazy. I mean, they're both lapping, I mean, they've gone into the high 30s now, both, and obviously the tyres dropping off a bit, but whatever we expected from them is definitely happening. Again, Cooper's not that far off, but he's just not as consistent. And pretty much soon, they're going to be looking at a pit stop in front of P4. In fact, I believe, actually, now they already are a pit stop in front of P4. So the top three are pretty much guaranteed a podium, as it is anyway.
Gresh in pit lane now, so the first multiple car's in pit lane.
Now, that is surprising. Has he lost his... he's lost his front wing, though. He's lost his front wing. I'm going to say, because that's a lot earlier than I expected them in. So we don't know what's happened to Gresh there. He's had an accident with something, maybe contact with the barrier.
Rick Scott looking onto Scott Bennett for ninth position, that is. Couldn't quite get it done, but Scott ran deep, and this is going to give Rick Scott a run now down to turn three. Rick's pulled left a little bit too quickly, and I think that's going to compromise him going down. Yeah, unfortunately, I was a little bit unfortunate. He pulled left too quickly. Oh, we've got Corey.
No, Bryson's off. Bryson's lost it. A tap from Cullen, and there's going to be an accident. No, they managed to avoid it. Bryson got tapped there from Cullen, who's been a gentleman. Cullen has been a true gentleman. He's about to let him back by for that P7 now, unfortunately, but they've just taken each other out. We're trying to go side by side through the fast right-hander in the beginning part of the sector. Cullen's done the gentleman thing now, he's letting back by. Good sportsmanship there from Philip. Really big pat on the back there, mate.
Bryson, in fact, Bryson's car looks about a little bit like a Ligier on board. Just noticed.
Yeah, I think Bryson's suspension damage, unfortunately. His car's pulling to the left because his right rear is smashed. His right rear is smashed because he's having to hold the steering wheel. It's like NASCAR. He's having to hold the steering wheel, like, not in central position in a straight line. It's slightly to the right there, so his car's trying to pull left. So, unfortunately, yeah, he's really struggling with that. Bryson's going to go backwards, unfortunately. Now, that's a real shame for him because he was driving so well. And that was no fault of his own either there. It was, unfortunately, it was all Phillips doing that because he was just too close in a slipstreaming zone. Tapped the back of him, sent him round. I mean, Philip, to be fair, did the fair thing, let him back pass, but unfortunately it's ruined Bryson's race from here in after, and he's letting Cullen pass now and saying, look, you know, you've done this to my car, I can't keep up with that pace anymore, just keep going, I'll try and do what I can.
Yeah, it looks like that's a bit of unfortunate there for them there. He's trying his best to take evasive action at one stage, but it just seemed to backfire on him. They went side by side, but I thought they might have been able to sort that out between them, and it's come off with Bryson with that amount of damage.
Right, key moment now coming up. Helston's coming around to the final corner. His pit light is on. Now, this, to me, if he pits now, is a two-stop. Unless he goes one-stop, soft tyre, hard tyre. He's got the gap. They've got a comfortable gap, and they should be able to work this between them. Yeah, Helston in the pit lane on lap 12, entering lap 13. Very early pit stop, and did he get that slow? Yeah, he just about got that slowed down. Kassar carries on. Now, you've got to believe Kassar being the next lap after, because the teammates, they're running similar strategies. Now, Cooper. Is Cooper on a one... You know, is he on a one-stop left than these lead guys? If he is, he's going to come out in front of Helston now, which is he's going to do that quite comfortably, actually. Cooper goes through to take P2 from Helston, who's still sat in pit lane. Now, the thing is, you've got to remember now, is obviously Dave would have been up there. You know, Muscat and that would have been up there without these spins and so on. They could have took advantage of this moment if they are on different strategies. Now we've got to watch Cooper and see if he does pit at the end of this lap or anywhere near the next few laps, or if he's on a one-stop. If he's on a one-stop, he's looking quite strong.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see when Petter and Alex Doolsine decide to pit. Currently, Let's just have a look here. We've got Pettit. Well, no pit light or anything. But we're quite only halfway around the lap, so there's still a bit more to come yet.
As Rouse just passed. Rouse has just passed two cars, so he doesn't make sure he has. He's gone up to P5. He's just passed Cullen and Muscat.
Yep, he has.
Cullen back inside. Cullen again, making a hash of it. And Muscat's. Oh, and he's taken two cars out in that. Cullen there, I mean, he's disgracing himself really here, because he didn't need to do that. He launched it back up the inside there. He was never going to slow that car down in a month of Sundays. He's just taken three cars out nearly in one manoeuvre, unfortunately. You were my man at the start, but unfortunately, it's all gone. I mean, Bryson's race has just been wrecked, and that's Cullen again that's done it, unfortunately. Well, it's not intentional, but...
Phil Cullen has shown his hand, certainly with a good lick of pace, but I think he needs to improve his racecraft, because he's really struggling at the moment when it comes to the overtaking and defending.
I mean, they can be forgiven slightly. It's round one, obviously, a bit rusty, but like you say, I mean, that's just... He didn't need to do that, you know what I mean? It was just very rushed and last-minute, like dive sort of thing. You know, obviously, thankfully, Rouse got away with it. Rouse, he's still in his P5, which he so handily took, and he's away with it now. Interestingly, Kassar did pit, but... Whoa!
Sorry, Petter nearly get wiped out by someone there. He was very, very lucky himself. Mal McKee spun, and he's trying to get back on. He's sitting in the middle of the track there, Mal McKee. He needs to move that car forward a little bit, or
has he stalled it? No, struggling. The engine's going.
He's still. Ooh, this is going to be dodgy. Yeah, Ricard takes evasive action. He's out of the way. That's fine. So Ricard has been able to navigate round. So when will we see? Petter's pit light's just gone on now.
Yeah, I did say it's going to go, but Petter's light has come on. Now, will he pit this lap? Now, you'd think so if his light's come on. Cooper's light, interestingly, still isn't on. Now, he's only got 22.8 seconds over Helston. This is Kassar we're talking of. Obviously, Helston's tyres are going to be taking a long time to come up to temperature. We believe he's had traffic on the outlap as well. It's now 23 seconds, so Kassar's pushing very hard here. He's done some good lap times, actually, the last few laps round. His sectors are pretty good. He enters pit lane now. He had around 4 seconds behind Helston to make up. He might have had a second of that up. Helston's now down to 24 seconds behind, so Helston's just had a scruffy middle sector. Kassar, well in the pit lane now. It's going to be close, this. Cooper's going to go for it to take the lead. That's one thing to keep note of. Cooper goes through, he's going to easily take the lead.
Yeah, he is indeed. Alex Cooper now takes the lead for the CSG. Petter is still in pit lane, so whereabouts are we looking for Ricard Helston? Okay, he's
putting the
foot on now.
He's going to get it. This is going to be very close. Kassar might have just done enough
speed,
here.
Kassar. Oh, they're going to be side by side going to turn one, aren't they? They are.
Well, Helston's got the advantage.
Whoa!
Around the outside. Helston's got the warmer tyres, more confidence. Even if Kassar would have come out in front of him there, I don't believe Kassar would have been able to hold him off for very long, because Helston's got, you know, the extra laps worth of tyre temperature there.
Yeah, absolutely. That's Ricard was just about able to get round Kassar. I think Kassar saw him come as well. May have just break that touch earlier. He didn't want any collisions going into turn one. He's 2 points. He's about 3.2 seconds behind now. So fresh, brand new tyres, and the gap. Like you said, he's actually just pulled that 1 second gap out, like you thought he would do.
It's actually up to 3 seconds now. Nearly 4 seconds. He's actually got back the lead. This is Helston. Obviously, he's got back the lap now. The gap that he had before. It's just the fresh tyres. Now Cooper is only 10.5 seconds in front of Helston now. But if he's on a one stop. That's 10.5 seconds advantage he's got, and that's pure, because they all need to do one stop again, in my eyes.
Absolutely. Rick Scott has unfortunately lost his rear wing for the second CSG car as well. I've just seen he's been coasting back down the back straight. So, yeah, when will we see Alex in? So, we're not too far off the one stop, are we? Because, well, halfway is 19-20 laps roughly, and he's just gone to lap 17 now.
Yeah, and he doesn't look like he's going to be fitting soon either. His lap times are pretty slow though. I mean, his tyres must be in bad condition. He's doing 32.5 now. As soon as Helston and Kassar's temperatures come up, I mean, Helston's just putting a 31.9 there. Obviously, early laps yet. He had traffic, he had to negotiate turn one. I've just seen Dave Carr Smith spin again actually recently, so he's having a nightmare this race.
You say that, Lee, but only if he even stays up for two more laps. The gap won't come down significantly enough. He'll still roughly have a 5 to 6 second advantage if those two cars have to pit again. I'm wondering if Petter will pit again. I wonder if he'll go to the end. Ricard might pit.
It depends, because if we need to look at the lap times when they get going, because obviously now, this lap now, the tyres should be pretty much up to their optimum temperature. I don't think Cooper's coming in this lap again, because his light's not on. He doesn't look like he's a man going to pit. Now, Elston didn't take much out of him last lap. Elston didn't take much out of him on last lap, and neither did Kassar. Kassar's tyres are now up to temperature, and he's matching his teammate again. Like you say, if Cooper can hold 9 or 10 seconds on him, that's good, because when Cooper comes out of his next pit stop, don't forget he's going to have to go through that pain of losing 4 or 5 seconds on the new tyres while they come up to temperature. And that's taken 2 laps for Kassar, and you notice now he's 4 seconds behind his teammate. So Cooper's got to remember that as well.
Hugely improved. He's just taking nearly half a second out in the middle sector. It's going up and up.
Okay, but don't
this
forget,
is going to get very interesting.
Don't forget also that when Cooper does come out of his pits and gets his tyres up to temperature, that's it, and he's going to the end. Helston and Kassar, if they do have to make a secondary pit stop, are going to have to go through that new tyre stage again, which will lose them 4 or 5 seconds. So whatever he loses in this stop on new tyres, on the warming up procedure, he's going to gain back anyway later on in the race. So you just got to keep it consistent. I'm just looking at the previous lap times. 31.8, 31.7 for the two Torrents behind him. Cooper was a lot slower than that. He was mid 32 again. He's really struggling at rear of that car now. His tyres are really starting to take a battering. It's not going to be long before they catch him. But have you noticed that their pace isn't as quick as it was before? They're lapping nearly 2 seconds slower than they were before. That's the two Torrent guys. Have they gone onto a harder compound to get them through to the end of the race now?
I wonder. I've just wondered that as well. I wonder if they have actually stopped early, gone from super soft to maybe medium hard possibly, and running all the way to the end. If so, I wonder what tyres Alex is on. That will emphasise how quick his qualifying was, even if he was on a slightly harder compound as well.
Right,
so,
Cooper's in this lap. Cooper's off this lap. Cooper was going to pit this lap, and he is going to be pitting, but for a new rear wing, unfortunately. Not for a new set of tyres and a boot
so
of fuel
unlucky.
Load. He's now going to be pitting for a brand new rear wing, and that is the race destroyer. This thing gets so held up there. Who was that? That was Mal McKee again. Mal really needs to open his eyes a little bit, because at the moment he's been a disastrous driver. What is he doing? He's just taken the leader out. Mal McKee, that is disgraceful, mate. That is absolutely shocking. Mal, just pull it off the track, retire it, mate, because that's appalling. And look at Kassar. Kassar's right
it's
on the back of Helston now.
He actually coasted, he actually pulled up. Petter pulled up. He could have flown by Ricard there, but Petter didn't. He pulled up because he's seen what happened, and has Ricard got damage from that?
He might have a slight side pod damage, yeah, because he got a good whack to the side pod there. But this is crazy. Obviously Cooper's out of it now. Anyway, we've lost him now. He's going to fall well down the order. So it's basically between the two Torrents now. At least these two guys have closed up a bit. And Kassar looking like he's really wanting to have a go at that. Obviously Kassar took a lot of time out of it there because of Mal McKee's, well, it has to be said, atrocious driving, unfortunately. I know he had a problem with the car, I believe, but you know, just park it if it's that bad. If you can't control your car, get it off the racetrack.
Meanwhile, Jack Nicklaus silently has moved up into third place.
He has, yeah. Jack is now on for a podium. That's so gutting for Cooper. I mean, he was just about to pit then. Those tyres were at the end of their life. And he was just about to pit, and I suspect goes to the end of the race. And these two run the harder compound by the looks of it. But, yeah, Helston, obviously, I'm really not sure what Mal McKee was doing there, but that was really appalling driving. Very gentle driving over from Petter Kassar to allow his teammate to continue, because Petter did have the opportunity to go by him there, I believe.
I think, you know, the thing that gets me is Cooper. I wonder if he had a puncher or something, because it was a very, I know he might have hit the curb slightly, but it was a very leery moment. I mean, he's been like leery for the last few laps, so the tyres must be near their, end of the lifespan.
He got to the inside wall quite quickly, and he may have tapped, you know, that very slight grass area next to the fencing, and I believe he may have just spun on that.
Well, at the moment, it's completely unexpected
so
to me.
So, just on that note, with everything that's just happened, even though, obviously, those two are still leading, the gap between them and Jack's 8 seconds. That was nearly 15-16 at one stage. But is Jack Pitt actually yet?
I was just going to say, the two, it's Hawkeye's third and fourth at the moment.
Yeah, it is.
Where have they come from?
Yeah, I don't think they've actually pitted yet, so...
No, they haven't.
The Hawkeye's still... Right, so we've got Scott Bennett, he's in fifth position. Fiddick is in sixth. Pestov's, who we barely mentioned, he's in seventh place. Great job there. Terence Gresh, he's in eighth. Jason
Miles in the gravel with the wheels.
Multiple force together. And Dave Carr-Smith's in tenth, and... he's catching the Multiforce guys, actually. So we may have the InnerVision car of Dave Carr-Smith catching the two Multiforce cars.
He's a lot faster, nearly 2 seconds that fast. I'd say Miles finally, I think, called it a day because he's gone off into the... In fact, he's still sat there in the gravel, I believe. He is. Well, he's trying to get out. He's got no wheels on the car. I don't know what Mal's playing at, but he's really not being sensible at all here. Considering he's a race director sometimes, he's really pathetic, to be honest, what he's doing at the moment. He's sat in the gravel, wheel spinning, with no wheels. Pull it off the track, Mal. Do us all a favour, mate. You've already taken about four cars out, you know what I mean? Rouse has got his pit light on. Nichols is still going round. Cassard's very close.
Mal's going to get out of the grab trap here. This is painful to watch.
Let's not give him the privilege, you know what I mean?
I'm not sure what he's playing out there. I just hope this does not compromise the leaders again, because this is really poor driving at the moment.
Bennett is all over the back of Rouse, and he had a go earlier and spun. He's actually back up to him again now, so Bennett's got good pace as well. Nichols and Rouse, obviously Rouse coming in this lap with the looks of it. Cassar right on the back of Helston though for the lead.
Scott Bennett's all over the back of Rouse, yeah. Didn't get the job done there. Oh, Rouse gone wide actually. Is he in a pit lane?
Enters the pits anyway.
Yeah, he is. So Rouse goes into pit lane and Bennett goes through, so Bennett's in 2-4.
Well, Nichols has actually... And what's Mal doing it? Mal's on the extra track round there. But Nichols has actually been catching the leaders in all this. Because obviously Nichols is on... he hasn't pitted yet. Probably on the harder compound tyre, I would have thought. Now the leaders are as well, you've got to presume. Because their lap times have just dropped off so much compared to what they were doing earlier. They've basically built a gap and then pitted for the hard compound. Quite a sensible strategy, actually. But Nichols now is lapping faster than the leaders, or at least matching them, because they're on the same tyres now. Muscat and Gresh back together for P7, P8, the two motor-forces. It's been pretty much a disaster to the defence of their title, it's got to be said. They're only in P7 and P8 because of the retirements in front of them, otherwise they would be probably well out of the top 10. As Muscat launches, won't be inside of Gresh, but doesn't make it. Gresh pulls over and lets him by, so Gresh, there, obviously they're on different strategies. Mal McKee still trying to get back to the pits. You just park it, to be honest, but...
Yeah, even if he gets back to the pits, he's going to have insane suspension damage, so not sure quite what he's trying to achieve here. He won't get any points even for finishing.
Pestov's in P5, he's going to pit this lap anyway, but he's done a good job to bring himself up through the field. Nichols still doesn't pit. The leaders are now lapping slightly faster that time. They've taken a good chunk out of him that time, but Nichols looking really solid for this podium. The only man who could probably challenge him is Bennett, in my eyes. I was going to say, Adam, do you want to do the... do you want to crank it up for the fans?
I think we should. I think now's a good point. We'll go on board with our leader of the race at the moment, which is Rickard Helston. Oh, no, Mal. Just no, Mal.
Oh, Mal! Jesus! He just nearly took out Helston as he came into the braking
zone. Yeah, Mal McKee really needs reporting.
Yeah, stop now. Come on.
Be sensible,
no,
Mal.
No, he's going to continue. He's going to try and continue.
He's not, because I'm going to message him.
Better park it. Come on now. That's three times we think he's taken out. Well, nearly taken out leaders.
Told him to get off track. I was thinking now we've calmed down again a bit. Should we crank it up for our viewers?
No, he's still not locked it. He's still going. What is he trying to achieve from here? Anyway.
Well, he's just sent me some discreet language back, which was really nice of him, which I'm going to worry about later. Because he's not, I mean, to be honest, he's been told to get off track by many people now, and he's still not doing it. What is he doing? Seriously. It's a disgrace.
It's not good to watch. Anyway. Earlier we noticed there was some very, very good sounds in this mod, especially when we're on board, so right now we're going to go on with Rickard Helston, go and go on board for just a few laps and sample some of these sounds.
Let's crank it up!
There we have it. Just a few laps on board with our current leader, just for the little soundbite there. Very good sounds in this spot, actually. 15 laps to go then. Ricard Helston is still in lead with teammate Petacasa just behind. You can see him there in the same shot. I really should know the team name by now.
Dark Motorsports?
That's the one. RP Forge, Dark Motorsports. There we go. Yeah, they're doing well, actually. A few little mishaps, not caused by themselves, obviously. But in terms of strategy, then, are we almost certain that they'll have to pit again?
No, I actually believe, personally, they're going to the end, but I've just been glad to see that Mal McKee's been removed from the game by the league administrator. I don't know what he was playing at there, Mal, but I messaged him twice and I got some nasty language back. So yeah, I'm really not impressed by Mal McKee there, considering he's usually someone who's quite... he's usually the man who sorts everything out, isn't he? You know what I mean? Like, he's usually the one who's very diplomatic. Yeah, great racing between two leaders, like you say. We were on board there for a few laps. Unfortunately, I think the broadcast went to an ad break or something at the time.
Yeah.
We didn't actually see most of that, but yeah. But Kassar looking like he's the quicker man at the moment, though, I must say, on these, which I believe, getting back to your question, are the harder compound tyres, and they are now going to the end of the race on these tyres, although their lap times have come down considerably. They're back down to the mid-30s now. Not pushing quite as hard, I don't believe, there's no reason to. So maybe they're going to the end, maybe they're going to pit again, we don't know. To be honest, they could both pit again and still come out in the lead, so it's up to them, really.
I'm just looking at third place man Nichols. He's quite a way behind now.
He's just actually made a pit stop on that last lap. He's made his pit stop finally. The battle that was got quite good at one stage was Bennett against Muscat. Bennett's by now, but they were very close together, and Bennett kind of nerfed Muscat out of the way, and it's promoted him up into fifth position now, with Adam Rouse further down the road, Jack Nichols' teammate. So it's encouraging for both those drivers that the fact that they've progressed and they are now in third and fourth for Nichols, Rouse, and then Bennett's obviously up into fifth, but understeering quite heavily in the second to final corner there, with Muscat closing again.
Yeah, it's almost like he's got damage. I actually think Bennett's got damage. He is, he's got damage. Bennett's got suspension damage, because he's holding his wheel to the right slightly down the straight, and he must have hit the wall on this lap, because he wasn't like this a minute ago. And like you say, he really understeered badly into that corner. Look at that.
I think he may have clipped the wall in the fast left right, and it's pulling now to one side, because Muscat is going to go up the inside of Bennett here, is he? No. Can Bennett stop? Whoa, he's going to oversteer. They're both going to oversteer. Whoa, that was lucky. They're still trying to keep on track, these two, more than anything by the looks of it, because they are losing significant time. It's allowing Terence Gresh actually close in on the other Multiforce GP car.
I think it just shows how quick Bennett is actually today, because although he's got Rick Scott right behind him now, who I believe on a softer compound tyre possibly, because he's very quick, but it just shows how quick Bennett could have been today. He's up there with that suspension damage, he's still keeping Muscat behind him, although he's going to inevitably lose that place, I believe, now, as a side-by-side. Now, this has happened before, let's see what happens again. Will Muscat try it again? He does, right round the outside, brilliant manoeuvre, although Bennett, he's got to remember, has got suspension damage, so probably couldn't defend as much as he'd like. Although he is retaliating now to the final part of that on the wrong line, he's on the outside, Rick's, and Muscat takes it.
Oh, Rick's just spun in front of Muscat spun in front of Bennett there.
Whoa.
As well. That was nice. That was a nice little moment there. Rick spun by him, but he did have good pace, and it shows the potential of that CSGT car, as you were saying. Muscat and Bennett got together, though, but like you said, Bennett's got some damage, and I think Muscat's now got some damage, and this is going to last the end, I think, between these two four, fifth and sixth positions, respectively, and with Adam Rouse 8 seconds further down the road. Up the inside, Scott Bennett into turn one, late break in, he's going to run on, he is indeed, he got that stop, well done, Scott Bennett. But this is going to be around the outside now for Jason Muscat. He will go to the inside line for turn three, he'll break later, he's got better straight line speed, I'm sure that's because Scott can't hold the wheel straight. Oh, he's nudged him! Ooh, Scott had his nose in front, he had that corner, and looks like Muscat was a little bit too keen and got into the side of him, spun him around, and it cost him himself. In fact, he's lost another position to his teammate Gresh there.
Indeed, Gresh has gone back past just one man I was going to point out as well, Alex Cooper, obviously, man that were racing up front early on for podiums, cutting down in P11 after all his misdemeanours, unfortunately. He's about to get back into the top 10 shortly, but way down the field now. But yeah, Muscat there, it's really surprising actually, he didn't manage to get that completed because Bennett has got suspension damage. And Muscat, you know, still didn't get past him, so got to get past Gresht again now. Meanwhile, I'll just say the two leaders are just, they're basically just enjoying themselves. They've got 12 laps to go now, 12 laps to go. I think Kassar could quite easily pass Helston. I wonder if they've got a McLaren 1998 deal on here, whoever led into turn one wins the race, because Kassar definitely could have passed him on numerous occasions now, as you've already pointed out as well, Nick.
Yeah, I think Simon Malyrish, team manager as well, will want to keep these two under control. He doesn't want to let them lose too much and cause too many issues between them. But I'd say at this stage of the race, Petters is the one with the better pace, because Ricard, yeah, is locking a lot, one thing, and he ran on just at the two corners before that as well. So Petters may be biding his time. We may see a bit of a dash to the end.
Well, if Simon's listening, come on, mate, let him race. We want to see a race, you know what I mean? This could be a great battle for the lead and championship, it looks like, because these two are very equally matched. So if Simon Mellowish is listening, then get rid of team orders, mate. Let's have some fair racing, see what happens. You know, we could have Jack Nicholls win it racing if these two take each other out. So.
And I believe he is actually listening, because I think we had a tweet from earlier that I couldn't read out. But yeah, hopefully he hears. And hopefully we get some racing out of it, because as you said, either one of these two will be competitors for the championship, no doubt now. And maybe even Jack Nicholls, if he gets some better starts in and tries a few strategy bits, maybe he'll be a contender from an early aspect anyway.
Well, you're right, Jack Nicholls, the battle for the podium's not over yet either, sorry, because Jack's P3, but he's only 8 seconds in front of his teammate Rouse. So that's still tasty in some respects, because there's plenty of time for Rouse to close that gap, although at the moment I believe he's lapping slightly slower, about half a second lap slower, so I think Jack's got that one covered. But I mean, we've got Muscat coming into the pits again with his teammate Gresh, is that, did I just see? They're both pitted together, yeah, the two motor forces are pitting together. So they weren't on one stop, they were on two stops, they were just very slow. And they've done a BAR, they've completely noshed this one up. I mean, they're in the same pit box, so they're going to have to queue. Gresh is having to wait here, because Muscat's in his pit box. So the reigning champion's motor force, really, really poor strategy. So the reigning champion's motor force, really, really poor strategy, poor pace, not what you expect to see.
No, that was really disappointing from Ultraforce. I was expecting a lot more from them. And Cooper is now back through, actually. He goes up into ninth. So, and Bryson, now that puts him back into eighth. It's Fiddick, the one that's actually moved up now. So Fiddick is now into seventh place. And Cullen, he's back up into sixth.
Yeah, Casale's just set for the slap at race, I believe, on 29.928.
He did, yeah.
And that's behind his teammate, obviously, with the slipstream out there. So and obviously, Helston set his fastest lap as well, I believe.
Yeah, he set his fastest lap with 30.
So they're pushing. They're pushing.
Yeah, these two are actually racing now. This is 10 laps to go, and these two want to race.
I think what we should do is, at this point, thanks Simon Mellowish for listening to us on this, because obviously he's letting them free.
Oh,
Kassar now is
going
to get a really good run out of the fast chicane. He's alongside, and he's going to take the lead here. So we've had a big change on that lap. Helston tries it on the outside. These two are racing. This is for the lead. This is superb. Kassar manages to just about keep control of his car. As Helston takes a ragged outside line and manages to keep his P1 place. So good defensive driving there from Helston. But he set himself up for that, because he ran wide at the chicane. Rick Scott gets nicely out of the way here. We've got a great lead here for the race, guys.
Yeah, indeed, we've got a great race going on between Helston and Kassar now. Kassar is closing on Helston once again, and I think these two are going to be pretty much dicing for the next 8-9 laps until the end.
Now let's just hope they keep it tidy, because obviously they've done the right thing. They've had the best strategy, the best pace, the best car. What we want to see now is we want to see a proper battle for this league, which we're actually getting now, thankfully. We thought they were under team orders at first, but it was just Kassar being a gentleman more than anything. which is we've definitely had before in the past. Kassar, one of the most gentleman drivers out there, and so is Elston in that respect. But they really have dominated this race, and it's good to see that they're allowed to race as well, because this is superb, and they're both on the absolute ragged edge.
Yeah, I'm sure the team manager Simon Malyushev is going to be very, very happy with what's going on here with the two guys at the front. Well, they're leading, but I'm sure he doesn't want to take each other off, but I think these two have too much experience to do that, as Helston ran wide again at the same corner as he did on the last lap. So looks like understeer creeping into that one Torrent car. The second Torrent car looks very hooked up. Yeah, again, very late under braking, locks the front tyres, so Ricciardo is struggling, but Petter looks very calm, cool and collected at the moment. Typical Norwegian.
Well, Muscat in P10 and Gresh in P11, after that farce of a pit stop, Muscat's actually got a drive-through penalty, even though he's in front of his teammate. I mean, he's going to put him even further down the field. He's going to drop Muscat way down to probably P12 and Gresh up to P10, so Motorforce having an absolute nightmare.
Yeah, Motorforce just going right off the boil now. Scott Bennett's still in a good race. He's 7.8 seconds in front of Phil Cullen, who's progressed back up through the field, and Fiddick is 2.3 seconds behind Cullen, but stopping? No? Oh, he's letting the leaders by. Okay, so Fiddick pulled over and he's let Kassar and Helston go by, so the leaders have lapsed all the way up to 7th at the moment.
Well, I personally believe that if Bennett didn't have, you just mentioned how good his race is, but if he didn't have that suspension damage, he'd be quite easily challenging for that podium place with Nichols now, because he weren't that far behind before the pit stops and that, and obviously now he's lost a lot of time, so I think he could be up there, but still the lead is together, and the advantage Kassar's got is obviously, and it's the classic saying, it's always easy to be to chase than it is to lead, and he at the moment, he can see that Helston is running wide, he can see he's locking brakes, he can see what state his tyre's in, you know, because he's that close. I mean, that's how close he is. He can see where the strengths and weaknesses are. The problem is, Helston obviously has come quite comfortable in some respects with the fact that Kassar's caught him and run him down, mainly through traffic, not through his own doing and mistakes. And now all of a sudden he's got to...
Oh, leaders there.
Yeah.
Oh, there's a front wing. Oh, two
there's
front
There's a lot of debris in the fact there.
Yeah, but...
Who's that?
I've just seen Koivunen just coming...
Koivunen and Bennett.
Oh, Bennett! It's Bennett!
Bennett.
So right. He's going to lose position to Fiddick. It is. Fiddick goes up another position.
I think Bennett's stop is actually scheduled, though.
Was the orange front wing on the track, so I wonder if it's for front wing as well.
I'm not sure, because it didn't actually show that being disappeared on mine. Maybe I could be wrong about that, though.
Wasn't too long in pit lane. Koivunen's still in pit lane himself, so maybe not, but there was definitely a front wing in between the two, the second to final corner and the final corner. Oh, and Bennett's just cut as well out of pit lane. I think he's just forgotten there. So, you're going to have to be careful on the regulations, actually. You can't be cutting the pit exit too much.
I'm actually pleased for Fiddick to be back up in P5, personally, because he got taken out early on twice, I believe, not for his own doing, and put well down the order. He's actually back up in P5, where I think he would have finished anyway, maybe even on the podium, Fiddick. So he's actually back up in a place where he should now, so I'm actually quite happy for him.
Yeah, Fiddick, that's a great job there for Fiddick, actually. Helston, huge moment again, going through that fast left-right. In the middle sector, that was a big, big moment. So these two, Kassar is really pushing Helston at the moment into a mistake, and it's not cost them a great deal of time. Obviously, they're a minute in front of Jack Nicholls now. So, yeah, these two have just dominated this race from the start at the moment.
Well, I think we can safely say that they're both not going to stop again, because there's only five laps left after this, so they are on the harder compound, we believe, now. And also, you were mentioning there about push, it is coming very close to push and shove now.
Look at the that, thing that they did fastest laps as well, 29.7
yeah,
for
look
Kassar,
at that.
29.8 for Helston.
But the thing is, the top speed is Kassar hasn't got the same top speed on his own that Helston has. I mean, he's looking at me inside now, but you just can't get close enough in the slipstream. Helston's got a very good top speed. It's like he's on a lower wing, so I don't actually think they're running the same setups here, or there's quite a bit of top speed difference between them. Kassar, when he's in the slipstream, he's
grip.
Matching out.
Kassar's got more grip here, for sure. Helston, he's locking up into a lot of these corners, so he's obviously carrying more speed into the corner. But I think Kassar's got the speed off the corner, he's got more grip. And is he going to look? No, he's not this time by.
That would make sense.
He missed the apex. Now, this could be an opportunity for Kassar as we head down to the sweeping right-hander. Helston's gone defensive straight away. He does have that straight line advantage because he's pulling away in a straight line. So you are right there, Lee. He has got a straight line advantage. The question is, can he hold it through these two corners? He does this time. So Helston does hold on, and Pettercaster will try and fight later on in the lap as Helston locks up against a go by Schroten there.
Yeah, good job from Schroten there. He's got clean out of the way of the leaders there, so big pat on the back to Schroten there, right out of the way there. The key there, you mentioned there about downforce. If Kassar has got a higher downforce package on his car, then that's going to benefit him tremendously with the older tyres and the harder tyres, because the harder tyre is harder to warm up, in which case he's going to get more grip earlier on. And secondly, especially with the slipstream he's got, he's not really losing out that much.
He's right on the back of him again. Through turn one there. He's right underneath the rear wing of Helston now. Is he going to get enough slipstream? He's going down the outside, late braking. No, Helston brakes even later and just holds the corner. That was a good defensive move there by Helston.
That's pretty amazing, to be honest. He can do that if he's on the lower downforce package, which we believe he is. It's slightly lower by the looks of it. In which case, he's doing well to brake that late, because you'd expect that Kassar would be able to brake slightly later than Helston. Obviously, we're not saying Kassar's on the limit at the moment, which I don't actually believe he is, because he looks very, you know, competent with his driving at the moment. Like, he's not really pushing that hard. It's Helston, like you said, who's under pressure. Locking brakes again, sliding in the rear. And look, he's got a bad drive out of there again. Not as bad as last time, it must be said, but still struggling to put the power down. Rear tyres must be in shreds by now. But look at this time. Kassar now suddenly looking like he can challenge in a straight line.
Wonder if he's changing boost.
I'm thinking the same. I wonder if
they're quite sure. There's actually a boost setting on these cars.
I'm not sure myself, but I'm wondering if they've been quite, you know, cautious on fuel in some respects up to this point. So they've got plenty left if they're able to send the boost.
Bit of a lock-up from Helston there, going into, I think Stokes or something like that, but anyway, yeah, bit of a lock-up, so he's showing a little bit of pressure now from Kassar, and Kassar actually looks like he's neatened up his act a bit in the last few laps. He's a lot more precise and a lot more calm.
Yeah, Kassar,
yeah, he's the man in control.
Looking feisty. Wow, that's a lot of speed carried through turn one again there from Kassar, just showing the amount of downforce he has, because Helston really locked that inside brake, and Kassar carried so much mid-corner speed there. That was tremendous mid-corner speed there. And he's really starting to control this car very, very well now as they head through the first sector over these curbs. As it looks like, again, Kassar is trying to close on Helston but can't quite do it at the moment.
The good thing for us as spectators is I think we're guaranteed a clean battle in some respects, because these two, as you've already pointed out in the past, Nicky, is that, you know, they've raced a hell of a lot together over the last 2 years. They're part of a team that they've been with for a long time. They do a lot of GT endurance racing together, and they're very successful with it. So they know each other very, very well. You know, so obviously, when it comes to dirty driving, I don't think these two are going to play a part in that. I think it'd be a very clean race.
Yeah, these two obviously they are actually GT teammates. As I was saying, alluding to before, they actually won a race at the weekend in GT cars, and they were teammates then. So this is going to be interesting. As Kassar's got a huge drive there, absolutely massive drive. I've got a feeling Kassar's got a problem. Is he's going to top out too early, because he's hitting the limiter of sixth gear very early on?
The thing is, though, before when he was in the limiter, Helston was still pulling away. That isn't happening now. It's almost like Elston's had to turn boost down or something like that, or he's having to save fuel, like, because his pace has dropped off. He's not as quick in a straight line anymore. I mean, if you watch now, look at Kassar closing up on him now. That didn't happen before. It wasn't as...
He's going to look in turn one, isn't he? He's going to carry
he's easing out the throttle, Kassar. Kassar's also easing out the throttle before they get to the braking. Obviously, it's not really a passing place anyway, turn one, in some respects, with the speeds they're carrying through there. But he's right in the slipstream now. Look, he's going to be forced to the outside once again. Helston defends the inside, brakes later. Kassar sits in behind him again.
Okay, there's no boost setting on these cars, so it just goes to show that they are able to race outright. So this is not a boost setting. This could just be Ricard. I wonder if he is trying to conserve fuel a bit, because all of a sudden, Kassar picked up the straight line speed all of a sudden again. So they're going ebbing and flowing at the moment between the two of them. And again, this is a great drive off the corner from Petter. So I wonder if he's conserved those rear tyres. And again, a lock-up from Helston.
But a good drive this time of Helston. He got a lock-up, but he got a good exit off there this time. And he's not giving Petter the chance to get anywhere near him, although Petter's closing up in the slipstream, obviously. The thing, like you said, if there's no boost on these cars, and obviously we didn't know that, the thing is, then, they must be saving fuel or something, or just easing off, saving engine wear. It could be engine wear, something like that. Because Kassar, there, look, he eases off. He sticks it at 170, and he lets off the throttle. Now, he can do 175 in the slipstream. I've seen that before, topping out. He didn't this time. He just eased off. And kept it at a steady 170. So Kassar isn't using the full percentage of his engine.
And the one thing Kassar does have to bear in mind, though, is he's been behind that car for a hell of a long time now, the best part of 20 laps, so maybe he's just keeping an eye on his engine temperatures, and maybe he's just holding back just a little bit. He's only got 2 laps to go, though, so now maybe he'll just try and rag it.
That's a very good point. Engine temperatures, obviously, he's not getting much cool air. Now, once again, off turn one, he's got a brilliant drive. He's in the slipstream again. Helston goes to the inside, as usual. This has happened 3 laps in a row now. But Kassar breaks later this time. Kassar tries to go around the outside of him. Helston says, no, you're not coming through there. This reminds me of Damon Hill and Jacques Villeneuve in the Williams-Renault 1996, the battle for the lead. It's just as good. It's very intense. 2 teammates, top of the game, racing for the win.
Yeah, absolutely. That was a great move there from Petter. He nearly got all the way around the outside, but Helston ran it deep into the corner and was able to hold the corner for long enough. And this is a great run again from Petter. Helston goes defensive towards the middle of the track. It depends now what he can do. Yeah, Kassar gets a lot more speed through the centre of the corner once again. That car is really hooked up through the middle part of the corner. And it's allowing a good run for Petter. And he's going to get right into the rear wing of Ricard again. As Ricard always carries more speed through the entrance of there. He always on the throttle. Or just carries more into the corner, it allows him to commit.
It's more in because Kassar backed out. I was on board with Kassar at the time. Kassar backs out the throttle. He lost 5-10 mile an hour by backing out the throttle there into the entry of the corner. And to me, that manoeuvre where he just tried a minute ago to go on the outside is just saying, look, I can break this late, can you? You know. And obviously, Ricard replied and said, yes, I can. So they're basically just testing each other at the moment. But we're coming in now. Is this this is the final lap, isn't it?
Yes. This, when they cross the line now, will be the start of the final lap, as there's a huge run for Petter as he looks inside turn one, knows he can't do it. He'll try and line up the middle part of the corner again. Look at the speed he carries through. Great
not
run
as good.
The corner this time from Ricard, though.
And they've got traffic, Rouse in front as well, so this is going to play a part.
This will play a part indeed. Rouse can see these two coming, and Ricard is trying to navigate. Oh, they're going to catch him in the fast part of the track as well, are they? Not quite. So, can Petter take an opportunistic move by getting past these the slower car of Rouse?
Ooh, Helston gets slow on the exit.
Slow
look
on
at
the
this
exit. Now, can Petter look to the inside? Which way does Rouse go? He stays on the inside. Ricard is able to hold the middle part of the track just about. Good run through the middle, though, for Petter. Ricard wasn't as quick through there. Now, can he get underneath the rear wing? He's not going to do it this part. He knows he can't do it now. Will there be full commitment from both drivers through this part now? No, again, Petter backs off, so he knows he can't follow him underneath that rear wing and get close enough. The aerodynamics won't allow him to do it. So there's not much more he can do now. This is going to be a lunge if he's going to try it anywhere. No, still he's underneath the rear wing.
Get this next corner tidy. He needs to get this corner tidy for a lunge in the inside of the final corner. He's not going to do it. He's
no,
going to do
he's
it, yeah.
Not. He's too wide. Big, big late braking manoeuvre. No, it's still not going to happen. So, Ricard Helston comes around the final corner. Huge oversteer. Comes around the final corner to win the first race of the Super Cup GPPW season, 2012 season, and Helston wins from Petter Kassar, a Torrent Motorsports 1-2, and a very happy Simon Malewish.
Brilliant battle. Brilliant battle between them two.
Very well deserved as well. Jack Nicholls is halfway round his final lap. He'll come through to take his first podium here at GPPWC in his first race as well, so very well done to him. Fourth place will be Adam Rouse by the end of this, just lapped by the leaders at the... What actually, was he lapped? Did he manage to stay out?
No, he was lapped, so that means the leaders lapped all the way up to fourth place. They didn't quite get Jack Nicholls. So
yeah, Nicholls is guaranteed. Yeah. Nicholls is guaranteed the podium now, whatever happens, so...
everyone bar Nicholls is finished then.
Right, yeah, Nicholls is going to be the last one to cross the line, because obviously he was still on the lead lap, and he's still completing his final lap at the moment. So
the
that is a great job from Jack Nicholls there.
Yeah, the only driver bar the two front runners to finish on the lead lap, so only 3 drivers doing so today.
Oh, he spun!
Oh god, no, well. Keep it out of the wall.
Oh, no,
it's fine, he's already got the podium anyway, it's not a problem.
Yeah, it's 75.
Not the way you wanted to cap this off though, with a spin on the final two corners.
Yeah.
3 corners.
Come on, Jack, bring it home.
There we go,
so Jack Nicholls finished in third position.
Yeah, he's slightly excited there about his podium finish, obviously. He's a good drive though, good drive, solid drive there from Jack Nicholls. Best at rest, definitely.
Very good. Right, I know there's a lot to choose from, but I will ask anyway for a driver of the day then.
I'll let Nick choose first, you
Driver of the day, I think because Ricard was able to sustain the pressure, it's got to be Ricard. I think he was absolutely superb. Got great start off the line as well and pulled that advantage. And I think he did a great job at the start, and he was able to maintain that pressure from his teammates. So Rickard Hellström for me.
Personally, for me, I'm going to get to David Fiddick, because I think after what he went through at the start, he deserved better than what he got at the start, and he's actually come away with a fifth place there after keeping his head in the traffic. He's come through the field, ended up fifth. Good job, David Fiddick, there. He's impressed me throughout this meeting.
Personally, I'm going to go for Adam Rouse. P4 finish, very good from him. He qualified very near to the outside of the top 10, or even outside the top 10. He's finished fourth today. Solid run for him, and I'm sure he'll be pleased with it. Anyway, that is the first race of this season then. Notable things out of this meeting. Trying to think of some points.
Just on that note, while they are going through the points minute, actually Dave Carr-Smith joined us. I apologise, yeah. Dave, I didn't see you join. I think we got a little bit heated in the in watching the ensuing battle between Petter and Rickard. So Dave, first Super Cup race, we saw how horrific your qualifying was and how many times you got held up. But how was it for you in your first Super Cup race for Innovision?
It was a bit of a nightmare, really, wasn't it? I don't know what happened at turn one, but I got tapped from somebody and the car was wrecked from that point on.
Yeah, I saw you had a significant amount of damage. You looked like you were holding your own, though, for a good few laps, and then it looked like almost the rear tyres gave up on you at one stage, or you had the damage was taking its toll. It's just unfortunate, I think, more so with the qualifying, though. I mean, qualifying, I believe it was three times, I think, we were going on board with you, and so you were held up.
Yeah, every time I was on for a probable 28, I managed to find somebody in the final sector, so that was fun. But yeah, in the race, I pitted on lap 7, I think it was. Fuel to the end, harder tyres, and I think, looking at the times, I probably would have ended up around 3rd or 4th. But coming through the fast kink in Sector 1, the car snapped from the damage and just couldn't hold it.
Dave, do you think you could have had the... obviously, you've had a clean running qualifying, we saw what happened. Do you think you could have had the pace to take pole position?
Possibly. I don't think any of the top four really set their best times due to the traffic, but I don't think I would have had the race pace to live with those two.
Well done anyway, like.
Yeah, very well done. Right then, I think that is just about all from us today. We'll thank everyone who's stuck with us throughout all the errors that we've had today as well. They will be fixed for next time, I promise. The next race is next week, I believe. Or I might have that wrong.
We've got the race winners in here if we've got time, mate.
Do we have time? do we have them?
We do, yeah. We've got Hellström and Petter Kassar, both race winners in here. Congratulations, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll start with our race winner then, Rickard Hellström. I suppose I'll start then with feelings. How does it feel to win your first race here at GPWC?
At the moment I'm pretty tired, but it feels quite amazing. I was expecting Petter to both take the pole and win, but I managed to beat him just by 1/10.
But yeah, it was a great battle between you guys. Those last 10 laps especially were absolutely stunning to watch. It was great on boards from both you guys. It looked like you were under a serious amount of pressure. There's quite a lot of brake lock in there. Did you feel the pressure for those final 10 laps?
Yeah, actually I felt them for the last 15 or 20 laps as my brakes just disappeared pretty much. It just got worse and worse and worse. I'm not sure why, but I surely didn't have the brake pressure or the brakes that Petter had. But the pressure from him was quite massive, actually.
Yeah, Pet, I don't know if you can speak, but do you believe, or do you think that you could have got past Rickard the other way than, obviously, I mean, you tried quite a few times to get past him, but Rickard defended really well. Do you think that you could have won that race?
Not with the setup that I had was using. I was actually going to use another setup with higher top speed, or higher gears.
But
I used the wrong setup, so I didn't have. I was almost topping out already without the slipstream.
And can you confirm that there are no team orders at TMO? So for the rest of the season, we're going to see a Prost and Senna battle between you?
If you check the log on TeamSpeak, I disconnected 15 laps before the end or something.
So there could have been team orders, but you didn't know about it.
Kind of.
Very clever.
But I noticed pretty early that I actually couldn't pass Rickard anyway without any mistake. It was only one time he did a mistake where I could do a real passing opportunity after the fast chicane.
Yeah, real good job to you two anyway for keeping it clean racing. It was really good to watch.
Yeah, the other times was actually no real overtaking maneuvers.
Johnny Bravo is expecting some wild lunges from you or something coming towards the end. You know, I know he's your GT teammate, but I was hoping for something more impressive to celebrate. But if people don't know, Petter's nickname is Johnny Bravo. You can ask him why.
Well, you can tell him about it.
Very good.
All right, then.
Another time.
Congratulations to both of you, and very well done today, of course. I've just checked, the next race is in 2 weeks' time in China, in the Shanghai circuit. Any sort of goals for that, or is it just to repeat what you've managed today?
Well, I think a 1-2 finish is possible, but yeah. I think Alex can be closer, I hope, in race pace. He was very quick in qualifying, but a bit off in race. But I'm expecting a good battle.
I think we always will aim for a 1-2 in league.
Yeah.
Were you both surprised in qualifying with just how quick both Alex Cooper were and Dave Carr-Smith were in qualifying? Because it looked like you guys had some good pace, but Alex was right there with you, and Dave was not too far off either.
Yeah, I'm not sure if I was that surprised, as both of me and Petter were struggling in qualifying. Both of us was about half a second off our personal best, but the track just felt slower. But it was quite nice, actually, that they was so quick.
Yeah, I just heard, sorry, that William Tringas has messaged me and told me that Scott Bennett got his damage in the opening lap, apparently. So he drove the entire race with bent suspension, so brilliant job from Scott, actually.
Got a message about that, actually, from Chris Williamson. I didn't forget at the time, but yeah, that must have been first lap. Actually, he was mid-pack, and that's where the accident was at the start, so that makes sense now.
It makes anyway, his drive look brilliant as well.
It does. Okay, I think we will wrap it up now. Thank you very much to Rickard Helsted, and Petter Kastel. Sorry about that. thank you very much for joining us, and best of luck in China in 2 weeks, well, in a week's time. So, from us here in the commentary box here at Albert Park, we will see you in a week. And thank you very much for joining us and sticking through all the problems we've had tonight. Been a GPV WC production for SimRace.tv. Ta-ra.